Good morning and welcome to Straight Up for Today, Monday the 19th of October 2015. A public holiday, National Heroes Day, isn't it? And working as usual, Straight Up being broadcast from the studios of New Stock 93 FM on the Mona campus of the University of West Indies. I'm your host, Jerry Small. And we're going to start, well, we have already started with that promo, which I made in mind and in view of the month of the activities, the heights of activities 150 years ago right up till now, height of activities in October pertaining to decision making amongst the people in Jamaica suffering injustice and disenfranchisement. And start out the promo with a piece of music that Dan Drummond and his brethren played, and it was named The Return of Paul Buckley. It was put out in 1965 when the whole resurrection of the Paul Buckley exploits was being promoted by the government and being examined by the people. So the promotion, the return of Paul Buckley, that Dan Drummond music, and I do the promo and so on. But next piece of music, there's another program on this station with this name, 96 Degrees. But this was inspired by the piece of music that Third World recorded, a piece of music, 96 Degrees in the Shade, commemorating the repression against the freedom movement in the St. Thomas and the surrounding parishes in 1865. Third early do that piece of music, 96 Degrees in the Shade, in mind of the repression, so the 96 Degrees in the Shade. Go and play that now. As in say, 96 degrees in the shade, and how much thousand soldiers on parade, those soldiers that was rallied and gathered to counteract the other soldiers not very well trained, the soldiers of the African people, the black people, disenfranchised African people in Jamaica. The soldiers of them, not very well trained, but decided to put them shoulder to the wheel, in the words of Paul Buckley. Not very well trained, not nearly as well trained as the Maroons, who were used against them. Paul Buckley tried to make a deal with the Maroons. The deal never held. The Maroons already had a deal, like what the present government have with Cameron. The Maroons already had a deal with the British government, like what the present government, the present so-called nanny. But they are embarrassed by Portia Sims Mill and the government using the image of nanny, because they know that with all of the failings of the Maroons, the present government and Portia Simpson Miller is nothing compared to Nanny, who differed from our brethren, our brothers, and the other Maroons. Differed from them and acted differently. But the Maroons, as I say, had a deal with the British, just like the deal that this present government have with Cameron and the Conservative Party. And because of that, Buckley was not able to secure any partnership with them as comrades in arms against the disenfranchisement of the African people in Jamaica. So Buckley's soldiers, male and female, were not nearly as well trained as the Maroons, and as a result of that, the Maroons were successful where Buckley was not successful. But the Maroons were successful after nearly 100 years of fighting. So Buckley people never really fail as such. They lost the battle, but they don't lose the war yet. They lost the battle, but they won't lose the war. 96 Degrees in the Shade by Third World. After that, I want to play, what is it that I want to play? Peter Tosh today. Peter Tosh Memory is being awarded the Order of Jamaica. Peter Tosh Memory is being awarded the Order of Jamaica. And go and play a piece of Peter Tosh. Can't take it no longer. Even now. we could get stronger. Not going to take it any longer. Not that I'm going to give up. Not going to take it any longer. So we have 96 degrees in the shade by third world. Then we have Peter Tosh. I forget a beat. Straight up.
96 degrees in the shade. Real hot in the shade. 96 degrees in the shade. Real hot, oh yes, in the shade.
Financial condition, I am unable to cope with this financial situation. It's causing an inflation upon creation.
I can't stand this no longer. The wicked get stronger. I can't stand this no longer. Cause the battle is getting hotter.
Do we get
against the wall. One step to progress, my brother, and I know Jah will help you all. And them have to get a beaten, Lord. They must get a beaten, yeah. Them have to get a beaten, I say. And them can't get away. I can't stand this no longer. Said them have to get a beating, yeah. They must get a beating, Lord. They have to get a beating, yeah. They must get a beating. Tell me, how long must the good suffer for the bad? Get a beating, Lord. They must get a beating, yeah. Them have to get a beating, Lord. And them can't get away, yeah. I can't stand this no longer. To get a beaten, Lord. Them have to get a beaten, brother. Them can't get away. I can't stand this no longer. The wicked get so strong. I can't stand this no longer. Everything seems to be wrong. Them have to get a beaten.
Yes, welcome back to Straight Up. You're well, you're still here. Yeah, so today is a National Heroes Day. I'm going to award Peter Tosh memory with a OJ out of Jamaica. And so on. I need to find out something. Anybody can contact Clinton Hutchinson, Dr. Clinton Hutchinson. I want to distinguish between his book launch and the screening of a documentary on Nanny of the Maroons. Both events have been announced as by other people, and I don't suppose by the promoters, as being on the 23rd of October, which I think is Friday. I want to find out if, and but I know one is the 21st and one is the 23rd. So I want to find out from Dr. Clinton on whether his own is the 21st or the 23rd, the launch of his book, which I think going to take place at the regional headquarters of the university across from the campus on Mona Road, or whether it Queen Nanny documentary, which I have to be screened on the October the 21st at the medical faculty, Sir Kenneth Stanley Lecture Hall, medical faculty at UWI. I don't even know what time on October 23rd. I need information about the difference between these two events. One, I think, is on the 21st, one on the 23rd. Clinton Hutton book launch about the Morant Bay organization and fight by Paul Bogland and Bridgen. I think it's named Skin for Skin or something like that. The book is about that. Clinton Hutton book, Dr. Clinton Hutton. And the Queen Nanny documentary. Just a few things before we read some text messages. We're not going to have the facility to take your text messages today, but we have some left from Friday. We're going to read them. Make sure read them. Before we get to take your phone calls, I just want to say a few things. You know, the liberation of people, or even naturally human beings are migratory beings, you know, are animals. Some people don't like to think of human beings as animals, but human beings do fall into the, not fall, stand in the category of animals, those living things which can move around and from place to place, differently from plants which are planted one place and can move around. One of them seed and them leaf, them can blow around and go somewhere else, go breed. The seed them of the plant, them some of them can blow around, and the leaves and move around, and the fruits and all kind of thing. Animal eat them fruits and go somewhere else and defecate out them seed, and the seed plant somewhere else. So the plant move, but only by animal moving them. Plants are planted, animals move around from place to place. So insect and human being is moving around by themselves. Them is animal. A human being is a migratory animal. Animal families of human beings and individual human beings move around from place to place, move short distances, move in circles and come back to the same place, or move far distance and don't come back to the same place. Move from heat to cold, and move from cold to heat, and from wet to dry, and dry to wet. They migrate for all different kind of reasons. They move from food to shelter. Sometimes they move from shelter to food and back. Migratory beings. And after a while, some human beings start to plant themselves one place. Not plant themselves not grown with roots like the trees, but to plant them neighborhood. Them come together with other people and become neighborhood, and then plant them neighborhood, them neighborliness, them neighborliness, and them love and affection, them plant it one place. They might roam and go other place, or they might go to sea and catch fish and come back, but them plant them neighborliness one place. Them plant them neighborhood one place. Sometime, and after a while. So human beings are both migratory, and them is also what them call what, sedentary. Sit down one place. Sit down one place, or sit at a place and then move and go back to them seat. Some of them are even moving on musical chairs, right? Them go back to the next person's seat. When the next person move on, them move on to that seat and go on moving and keep on moving. And you know that somebody was here before you, and what them did eat the last time they meet, and all kind of different signs. Sometimes I'll start leave left sign for the other people who come here. Left sign all upon tree. You mark on, make also mark upon the tree as a sign to other people who come in behind, say, water is nearby, or no water now come till them leaf a turn yellow, and all kind of different signs start make us. So we start writing, making sign upon tree and upon stone. We start make mistake and make sign all in the sand till we find out, say, you have a wave, we go wash with all your writing. So the mother will make no sign of the sand unless you know the person go pass there before the high tide, come wash with that. Come wipe with that like a blackboard or a whiteboard. I nobody write no love letters in the sand unless I just a little exercise. I just do some writing, penmanship practice and all them kind of thing. Yes, so the human being is migrator as well as them put down roots and stay one place, and them all sometimes them all expand all them territories and run with other human being or other animal from that territory. Them landholder. Them become landholder after a while. Human being become landholder. Or the stronger one become landholder. Sometimes them become all slaveholder too. Slaveholder. A whole land upon land. Run with all other human being. And when there was enough space, that's good enough. You whole land upon piece of land because there's enough space so everybody could claim some of that land. But some people get overstrong and claim everywhere. And become landholder as against landless people. And then become even slaveholder as against slave master. Sometimes migration is an alternative to even liberation, or sometimes migration can be a form of liberation too. Liberation, migration. All these things are brought to mind by the day-to-day happenings, you know. And the millennium to millennium happening, things happening from thousand of years to thousand of years, and million year to million year, and things happening from day to day. Some people who I, from me about 3, 4, 5 years old, I become aware of them, at least 5 years old, become aware of them. Cynthia Wilmot and Fred Wilmot. I get to know them by them radio voices, just like how I never get to know the man where I call Buckner, the man who always phone the program here and talk about Buckner in Clarendon, where I'm come from, and the problems in Buckner. I always call about Bull Bay and the problems in Bull Bay, 10 mile, another place, 9 mile. Mr. Buckner, I call Mr. Brown, my real name. He, and it's coincidental, you know, because Mr. Buckner live out of Bull Bay. Cynthia Wilmot and Fred Wilmot live most of them Jamaican life of 60, more than 60 years. Them live most of them life in Bull Bay on the beach there too. 7, 8 mile Bull Bay. It's about 9 mile, 10 mile. Cynthia Wilmot and Fred Wilmot, when I come to know them, I get to know them just like how I get to know Mr. Buckner. On the radio, I hear him a calling Mr. Buckner. Get to know him. I hear Cynthia Wilmot and Fred Wilmot talk on the radio when I'm a little boy about 3, 4 years old. Have all kind of different program. Have a radio play them, have music program, all kind of thing, cooking program. With some slightly American accent. I couldn't tell the difference between Canadian accent and American accent, but get to know Cynthia and Fred Wilmot through the radio later, get to know them in person, get to know all them son them. Last son that you know, most of you know, is Billy Wilmot, who is CC in a Royal Palm Estate, and also the musician, I think him lead, what that band name again? Can't remember the band, he have a very prominent international reggae band. He must have more bridging. They migrate, come to Jamaica and look how great. Look how great a part of Jamaican history they have become. The Wilmot family become a great part of Jamaican history because them contribute. If them never contribute, them wouldn't be a great part of Jamaican history. So we get to know them, they become family. Them been living in Jamaica before, vast majority of Jamaicans. Them been living in Jamaica about 62 years, I think. That is longer than vast, more than two-thirds of the Jamaican people not been living in Jamaica so long. So them come see Fred and Cynthia Wilmot living in Jamaica and raising them children in Jamaica till them children turn grandparents. And them become part of Jamaica through migration. Some migrate come in and some migrate go out. Emigration. Emigration are when you migrate go out. And immigration are when you migrate come in. So them emigrate from Canada to Jamaica. And them become part of Jamaica and them help build up Jamaica. Cynthia Wilmot passed away last week, I believe it was. At 94 years old. 94 years old, and we're going to talk some more about her and find out some more about her. And other people migrate out and them not running. If I say them run away from Jamaica. Even Bob Marley. Many other people migrate out of Jamaica, exile out of Jamaica, run from Jamaica. Up to last night I was at function saying farewell to a family, the Green. Mr. Sam Green, Reverend Sam Green and him family. Migrate to another place. After them do some great work, imagine. It's not until him retire, until him reach an elder, him reach retirement age. That's when him leave Jamaica. So you couldn't say him a run, him never do nothing. Him spend him whole life, working life in Jamaica. And him and him family were well missed. That's why them put on a big celebration for them down at, over at Grace Missionary Church last night. I meet a whole lot of people. When he yell some of them, to his, even some of the people that I met at Mr. Brown, same man I call Buckner or phone the program all the while. Sometimes when I'm talking, I'll hiccup too. But some of the people that I met, including starting with the family of Mr. Brown, when he helped plenty of them too. Because, you know, especially on a long weekend, a holiday weekend, you're more liable to meet a lot of people because that's the time when people have time to mix and mingle and all them kind. But how about mix and mingle? I think tonight is the last night of the Marathon reunion. What them call Last Lick. Is it at the deck or is it at Waterfall? I think it's at the deck, you know. The deck. Last Lick of the Marathon reunion tonight. Heroes Day and Night. So we're talking about migration and animal life and all kind of thing. And people migrate, come to Jamaica, come help build up Jamaica people. Build up Jamaica and then migrate go somewhere else. go build up that other place and all them kind of way. So this is how life goes, this is how human being move. And sometimes this is part of liberation development. I remember once my daughter was migrating out of Jamaica in 1999, and she was embarrassed and ashamed that she had to be leaving Jamaica in order to maintain the plan that she have, the plan and the building that she's doing. It was very difficult to continue building at that rate. And she migrated out of Jamaica to maintain the momentum of the building, of family and building of other things that she's doing. She feel embarrassed, and I had to remind her that she shouldn't feel embarrassed because she has done a great amount of work here already. And most of the people who have done the greatest things in Jamaica, a lot of them, migrated at one time or another, whether they migrate as farm workers, or they migrate as student, because even when a student go away and study for 3 years and come back, you know, they migrate. Or whether they migrate as refugee, or them take asylum, you know, have to run away from Jamaica for a time, or run away from any country, till it's safe for them to go back home. Bob Marley did it, many other people do it. You have people all claim to them have to run away from Jamaica because they are not safe here as homosexuals, so them seek asylum other places. Sometimes they seek asylum other places and get all fame and fortune too. Sometimes they all get some big award and prize for what? Escaping out of Jamaica and making doing it good in the next country. And then make some, them give them some big award. Say, yes, you ran away from Jamaica and you came here and did good. And we're going to award it a big prize. And make Jamaica know, say, their loss is our gain. Jamaica lose them, but we get them and we're going to big them up and Jamaica did harass them. And you score some political points that way also. The same time, the people, you know, Paul Bogle and him female, them and him ladies around him, and George William Gordon and the men and women around, man and woman around him and all those people. They were well advanced in them thinking, you know, more advanced in them thinking than most Jamaican here now, 150 years old, 150 years later. Very, very advanced in them thinking, and even in some of them decision making, some of them, not all of them. Very advanced and very active, and there was a little dumb people who don't know what to do or don't know how to analyze the situation. Very well advanced in them thinking and them action, some of them action. And same time they had to be protesting about the injustice in Jamaica and the taking away of land and all kind of different, taking away of rights and justice. Same time they were doing that, other people were being brought to Jamaica to replace them as workers. People were being brought from China. People are being brought from India under much better conditions of getting steady pay and get them food and clothes for 5 years. And when the 5 years done, them get them lump sum of money, like it was a farm working scheme, you know, the people who came from China and India. Meanwhile, the African people are suffering enough to fight for them rights, even with physically fight for them rights. Indians and Chinese were being brought here on a better scheme, a farm work scheme where them can save up money, get them passage, get them ticket to go back to India when them and China when them finish work 5 years. And get a lump sum of money. And if them don't want the ticket back to India and China, them get all some land at Jamaica. Much better scheme than the capturing and the prisoner of war status of the Africans in Jamaica. So meanwhile we was carrying out a liberation struggle in 1865. Chinese and Indians was being brought here in a migration scheme. And them come here and become citizens of Jamaica and become part of the strong Jamaican community. And they make them plan and they become very strong economically. And I don't grudge them at all. I admire them for that, the Indian and Chinese community in Jamaica. Some of them migrate afterward and go other place. Yeah, plenty Indian and Chinese migrate and go other place after them make it in Jamaica. Because that's how human beings stay. Anyway, been talking for some time and it come now to, I want to talk about the tax, the woman with them take her car. Take her car 4 years ago, ram into her car, transport her 30 people, smash into her car, take away the car for 4 years. And she sued them and get $10 million plus for having to rent a car for 4 years. That's the kind of treatment still taking place 150 years after Paul Bogle. That's the kind of action, that's the kind of thing that did happen with Paul Bogle and him friend him decide to get together and storm the courthouse, you know. Because different from this lady here getting the $10 million plus. Congratulations to the, whoever delivered that justice to her. Different from some right now getting injustice, the opposite thing. Plenty, although she get the $10 million, plenty other getting worse injustice. People all dead, I think all women all dead, you know, all women in a taxi. Man and woman in a taxi get all shot after being rammed by transport authority. 150 years after Paul Bogle, so although $10 million, I want to this woman and thank goodness for that. 150 years after Paul Bogle and the Morant Bay movements, people still getting this kind of abuse. Plenty by the 10,000s and the thousands of thousands, this kind of thing happening still here in Jamaica. The kind of thing that did prompt Paul Bogle and them people to storm the Morant Bay courthouse. We have a phone call there or some text message. We can take phone call today though. Don't. I'll go and read some text messages from Friday, please. Text message. Alright. I'm going to remember. Alright, I'm going to take the phone call then we'll remember the text message. And I have a whole heap of people for Yale, so don't bother believe we forget about that. We don't forget that. I have not forgotten about that. And that is due to be done. Overdue too. Good morning and welcome to
Morning, Jerry.
Welcome. How are you doing?
Clinton Hutton book is Wednesday.
That's the 21st.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Wednesday the 21st for Clinton Hutton book launch at the regional quarters of the University of West Indies.
And the band where I try to remember, Mystic Revealer.
Mm-hmm.
Billy Mystic.
Yeah man, Billy Mystic, Billy Wilmot, son of Fred Wilmot and Cynthia Wilmot. Thank you very much, Gan. Yes.
As I remember Peter Tosh,
yeah.
My own mother would have been 85 today.
Oh yeah?
Yes. And as you talk about the migration, she was born in Trinidad.
Oh yeah, your mother, yeah?
Yeah, Jamaican parents.
Oh yes, sir. How them did reach over there?
Well, you see, our parents was Salvation Army.
Oh.
So they have four children. Every one of them born somewhere different.
Yeah.
Yeah, because one brother, Barry Johnson, was
born. Barry Johnson, where you say?
Yeah, was born in Barbados.
Yeah, man, that Jamaican Barbadian actor.
Yeah. And our big sister was born in Guyana.
Yeah.
And our little sister was born in Jamaica.
Yeah.
But Jamaican parents, you know?
Yeah.
They were all over the place.
A real Caribbean, Afro-Caribbean people.
Yeah, because, all right, my grandparents now.
Mm.
You know my cousin, the journalist.
Which one that?
A Walker. Carol Walker.
Oh, yeah. Carol, what you say?
Yeah.
Chassis?
Yeah.
Are your cousin?
Yeah.
Oh, that's what Red Hills Road good for.
Well, same family them now. Same Salvation Army officer, same grandchildren.
Oh, wow.
But then they are Africa, so una born in Nigeria, born in Sierra Leone.
I tell you, man. You know, when me a teenager and my year Rastafari, you know, me start. I respect the Salvation Army people more. First thing, my old man always tell me, say, it's one of the best religious congregation because them really serve people and help people. And the next thing is that, you know the slogan of Salvation Army?
Go.
Do you know the slogan of Salvation Army?
I remember it.
Them weird upon them shirt collar, man. The yeah. S. The S upon the shirt collar have been three words. It's sewing upon the S. In the S. Three words sewing upon the S.
Yeah.
Blood and fire.
Yeah, man. The war cry. Them book name.
The war cry. Yes. So, they name army them name, you know.
Yeah.
Salvation.
Yeah.
And, you know, so blood and fire was one of the favorite slogan of Rastafari at that time. Yeah. And that's why the PNP used to use up a whole Rastafari slogan. And that's why Norman man let bring blood and fire at Trope and Siaga on the October day, 1965, 50 years ago. And Siaga say, if you think of you and can blood and fire, Yeah, man, Salvation Army, great. They were greatly pleased with that to go there, man.
Yeah. Give thanks.
Thank you very much. You have another call. Morning, welcome to Straight Up, hello.
Morning, Jerry.
Welcome, sir. What's going
on? Lady, I'm glad to see she get the money there. There's enough people harassed somewhere illegally. But our free college, I know, coming like that, there, I'm not doing them. About 19 or something, I don't remember.
Mr. Mill would win some billions, but him die trying.
Then that's the matter about, make it stress him out to the man dead. Some people say, oh, yeah. But anyway, it's stress out to him dead. But what me did love about that story with him, was when the other them for piano never appeared, and him go and start touring for them bus.
Yes, it's beautiful.
That story me did love, touring for them bus, and then them have to call Cree.
Yes, man. Beautiful, beautiful.
You know, so I hope she...
Him give them some of them one medicine.
Yes, man. Because then some of them people are getting money so bad, a little authority and...
Yeah, a little brief on. A little brief on. Yeah, man. A little brief authority.
Yeah, man. Because one of my friends, you know, they're doing something, well, not similar, but he was taking it, every Sunday, taking family to the beach. And we have a red plate.
Yeah.
And him driving to the beach with his family, and I stop him. Yeah. Then go out of the vehicle. Tell him to him driving contrary to his route.
Imagine.
And that's why I tell him to family.
Him not driving. Him not driving contrary to his route. Operating contrary to...
Operating contrary to route.
After the man I take with his family. But him operating.
Yeah. So anyway, when him go court now, him wait till him go court. But take out back in car, and can't take out back in car or whatever. So Mr. Man, you're mad. No, I never take it on to keep it for how long.
I'm not sure.
Anyway, I'm going to court and you say to the judge and tell him, just say, why you never tell him? So I tried to tell him, but since he knows better than me, I figure he even listen to you more.
Yeah.
So you can bring him family to court and everything, I swear, and I give him a bit. But he missed the opportunity to get the money out of them.
I see him one time in my bacon. My bacon, some police, one police lick my car and now I fix my car. And them come on me yard, come thief my car. In order to counteract me taking action against them, them come on me yard. Police come on me yard and steal my car. No? And carry. Steal my car. Them broke in on my car, push them hand through the window, open the door, and push the car. Because I fix the car that not them can't start it. I fix the car that nobody can't start it. Them push my car from upper Elliston Road where I live, down to Elliston Road Police Station and seize my car. Thief my car and have my car down to Elliston Road Police Station. And when I go to court, and in the car, them carry away the documents for five other vehicles I have. So I can't drive none of the other vehicles. Meanwhile, them thief that one. And when I go to court, I make the judge know, so them thief my car. Everybody laugh and she laugh too, but when I explain to her, she ordered the policeman to be our arrest warrant for gold for him immediately. And anyway, long story short, them not like when you understand yourself and know your rights and stand up. Some of them don't like it. But fortunately, most people love it. Thank you. Thank you.
You hear anything? Well, I think it's this week anyway. I listen out to the story from the girl. Hilda's girl. So I'm going to keep...
Yes, man. You have a front page of yesterday's paper. Public defender get involved.
Yeah.
Give congratulations to Makulo, what's his name? Matunde or whatever, the previous public defender who got involved early, and many other people who have been pushing it. This story was broken on this program and on this station here.
Yeah.
And it gone and out till the girl is a celebrated issue. Thank you very much to Tekla McFett who bring it to light. And when anybody fighting a good fight, you're not fighting for yourself anyway, fight for many other people. So this girl you know standing up. And there's many people going to benefit. Religious rights and all different kind of rights in Jamaica.
One Kaboo program. I was saying, the girl was planning not to take it back.
Yeah.
But everybody start encouraging her. Saying, no, you have to look at it positively and take it. You know, Kakabu was saying that's probably, no, you're just getting your role in life in the direction where your life is supposed to go.
Yes, we have to go for a break. Yeah, man. Thank you. We have to go for a break here.
All right, boss.
Thank you very much. Let's go for a break. Thank you very much. Welcome back to Straight Up. Good morning.
Yes, Jerry.
Wagwan, sir.
Well, they say today's Heroes Day, but as far as I see it right now, I'm celebrating the heroes.
Yeah.
But should I be celebrating these people that told us out? Right in the present of Heroes Day, you go and you make agreement with the same slave drivers to put us under more slavery.
No,
and you are denying it.
No, it's not. They make agreement to the slave drivers, you know. They are the slave drivers.
Mm-hmm.
The slave driver is a slave too, you know.
Yes.
So this Jamaica government is a slave driver.
Yeah. Hmm? And I can't understand, Jerry. The British government said, it's on their website that they signed the agreement. Yet still our government are denying that they signed any agreement.
Yeah,
who should we believe?
We know the record of these people here.
Yeah.
And the British government is boasting about achieving certain things. Meanwhile, these ones are denying it. They have been exposed.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't believe the one who is exposed?
I couldn't do that.
They are exposed.
I don't know that me and you are talking now. Look what Paul Vogel have done. Look what all these people have done because they decided, no, they are not going to live that type of life. This man governor here even break the law. But the amount of people that he end up killing, you know, he break the law, you know. He will extend the martial law for his own selfish need.
Yeah.
And with so many people got killed. And then the British government has supported him in defending him.
Then many times them broke the law, like, including 1976 when Michael Manley and him government tell a whole heap of lie. And set up a whole heap of things. Enough time them broke the law. Then Al Green Bay, them broke the law, them broke my neck, them broke everything. And the JLP government broke the law all the while and do things all like Carl Gans and many other things too.
Yes. Because when I talk to Jerry, you know, I go across political line.
Yeah.
I'm not saying one do this and the other one won't do it. Both of them, they are the one that put this country in the state where it is now.
Is them together make the, this sellout where this government, you know, do with Cameron. The two party that come together and make the biggest sellout in 1962.
Mm-hmm.
And we've been talking about it. But them don't have to reply. Them don't reply now. When the Jamaican people talk about how 1962 was a sellout and it's not really independent, them don't bother reply.
They don't have to. They don't have to because they don't respect us.
No,
All they do when they want their vote, them come and them tell us how much they love us and they are going to do this and do that.
But I'm tired of just making the complaint. So let's move on. Thank you, bro. When I say move on, not move on from the topic now. Move on
No.
Hold on. Move on to do some things. Thank you very much, yes, sir. Next one.
All right, then.
Morning and welcome to Straight Up, hello.
Morning, Jerry.
Welcome.
The bridge you know talk before, Mr. Fox.
Yeah.
You ever have him as guest on a program, eh?
No.
He's one of your brethren.
Well, I never meet him. I don't remember meeting him face to face yet. Yet some of them I meet face to face, I'm forgetting it. But like Mr. Buckner, I got Mr. Buckner funeral yesterday. And it's the first time I ever see him face.
Okay.
Even though
he was one in Manchester.
No man, he was in Clarendon, but him live at Bull Bay, so I'm always phone a talk about problems in Bull Bay and in Clarendon. And I'm always when Damien Crawford come in, I'm always a talk about things that Damien Crawford should come and look at down in Fame area.
Okay.
If you hear him voice, you don't know who, but I don't remember meeting this brother, but you suggest that
I'm wondering if it's him called you one time. I was telling you the interpretation of a diggle diggle, the cat on the fiddle.
Very likely, because that's the kind of information I'm always clarify.
Yeah. Because I think I like his, you know,
something.
And I remember him was clearing up some Latin
pronunciation
with you.
Yeah, man. Him do that all about, yes, man.
Yeah, so him sound like somebody you should have on your program.
Yes, and you know that from time to time we do invite some of the callers. And yes, it's time I update some of that list in there. And I have a couple of ladies I'm going to invite that I'm not ready for coming yet neither.
I want facts, not interpretation. How and when and why Bustamante was given, sir?
Was given knighthood?
Knighthood,
and serve the British government and the Queen well, because they use them to set up the first so-called party government in Jamaica, 1944.
And that is the official reason.
I don't know what reason them. I don't remember what reason them get them.
Because what I'm saying, I don't want the interpretation, very small interpretation. I want.
No, you could not.
You know why I asked you?
You would have, yeah.
I remember you saying,
yeah,
that the British were more from Norman Manley.
Me saying that them was more from Norman Manley?
Yeah, they had wanted him to do some bidding more than even the JLP. They had a fallout with Bustamante.
No, you'd have to get it clearer than that, because what you're saying even now is not clear. They wanted Norman Manley to do.
I don't know, you know, he's listening to you, so maybe.
No,
I
wait, no, memory stated. Huh?
Mm.
Are you saying that I said that they wanted Norman Manley to do some bidding?
Yeah, they're more.
But, make a finish, man. They wanted Norman Manley to do some bidding, but he wouldn't do it, but they really preferred him. That's what I said.
No.
All right, what I know is this. That both Bustamante, specifically, more than one time, but specifically in 1942 when them put him in a camp, when them confined him in a camp during the war, said that the kind of excitement that he must stir up out the road is dangerous for the British during the middle of a war. So them put him in a camp. And he was in there.
So he was a rebel like.
Yeah, he was in there from 1940 to 1942, February. And while he was in there, they came to an understanding with him that if he break away from the PNP, you know Bustamante was in the PNP?
Yeah, I think they say he was one of the founding.
Yes, and not only was in PNP, he was the physical defense of the PNP. Him and him BIT was the physical battle axe of the PNP. So the British make him know that if he leave out of the PNP and form a party, they will allow him to become. They will do what will likely lead to him to become the first leader of a party government in Jamaica instead of Manley. That was in 1942 they made that deal. In 1952 now they make a deal with the PNP that them tired of Bustamante, you know, after two terms. And if the PNP clean out the communists them and some of the workers representative out of the PNP and get them out of the leadership.
The communists?
Yes, communists. There were some communists in the PNP.
Yes, sir.
And they were organizing. Most of the party organization we see now is remnants of their ideas and the party groups. And
okay.
Well,
so the flame of communism in the PNP was almost like a real thing then?
PNP was formed as a socialist party.
Okay.
And socialists and communists around the world frequently. Make me finish my sentence.
Yes, sir.
Communists and socialists around the world frequently work with one another up to a certain point.
I hear you.
And most of the communists in Jamaica were aligned with the PNP. And some of them was in it and was high in the leadership. Like, for instance, Ken Hill. Ken Hill was almost as strong a leader in the PNP as Norman Manley. And the same British and other people pointed out to Manley that he's a threat to you. And you have to move him. Not only because he's a threat as a big personality and a great speaker, greater than Norman Manley, but a threat as a communist who going to use Manley and push him one side later. So the PNP made a deal mostly through people like Glasspool and Wills Isaacs. Norman Manley wasn't that much for it. They make a deal, say, if you clean out these people, we will allow you to to farm. We'll do the things that will help you to farm the next government and get out Buster. The two of them make deal. One in four.
The English people promising that.
One in 1942, Buster, and the PNP in 1952, 10 years. Do we go for a break, 10 o'clock? But thank you very much, here, sir.
Okay. You're not finished, but all right.
We have to go for a break.
All right.
And we have to go for the next call. But call again before the program finishes.
Yeah, man, cool.
The Return of Paul Bogle by Dan Drummond. Sooner or later, but most, the dam going bust and everyone going break out. And who will stop them? The force?
Which force can stop this river of ones who already know their course? Straight up with Jerry Small, 9 to 12, weekdays, 93 FM. Kabaka Pyramid, well done.
We are the politicians and them. In your face, them a smile up. Behind your back, I'm only them a pile up. Try to start your business and them quick for spoil up. Hey, well done. Well done, Mr. Politician Man. You done a wonderful job and tear down with country demolition, man. Civilly bang, well done. Well done, Mr. Politician Man. You done such a great job selling out with country with your business plan. Well, you forget a round of applause.
Welcome back to Straight Up. I'm your host, Jerry Small. I'm into the second hour of this National Heroes Day, October 19th program. I'm going to read some text messages from Friday, please. First one. Jerry, the one world government is already here. In fact, it's what we call the system. Next one. Mr. Small, do you have any idea how Jamaica sell the bauxite? Is it by pounds or by cartload, Jamaica and Canada? I think them sell the rights. I think them sell the right, the mining rights to the companies. A certain areas of land and that kind of thing. Certain areas of land. And I think them have ways to measure how many tons. How many tons have been mined. But I don't know if they measure it accurately. I don't know what kind of cookery go on between them and the companies. Next one. Jerry, I notice your old friends are careful not to speak of past controversies on the air. I'm trying to figure out what you're talking about here now. I notice your old friends are careful not to speak of past controversies on the air. What you're talking about? If you send a text message, try make it be understandable. But we don't really have to read them, you know. We don't have to read none of the text messages, you know. But we still read them. So try to make them understandable. Next one. Bongo, in recent times, the Brits suspended the Turks on Caicos. The Brits suspended the Turks on Caicos. Oh, you mean they suspended them constitution? I think that's what you mean, yeah. Next one. Morning, Mr. Small. I am Errol McLean, otherwise known as Flavor. I am living on the streets from 19th of March, 2013. I'm very sick and need to do a surgery. Please, Mr. Small, I'm badly need help. Read on the air, Flavor from Augustown. They're living on the street in Augustown. You'd have to make us know more. Next one, Jerry, Jamaicans are not Africans. We have our own identity. That's the same one where Sam noticed the old friends. I don't know if it's him or she. But most time the women them not as foolish as the men them. It's the same one where I said, Jerry, I notice your old friends are careful not to speak of past controversies on the earth, saying Jamaicans are not Africans. We have our own identity. So we're getting to know this text a little better, know what level their mind operating at. Next one, Jerry, good day. Please play the song Sin Don't Live Here Anymore by Candy Staton. And this is dedicated to me, Patrick Socks Howell. Oh, Candy Staton is a very, very beautiful voice and very nice personality female singer from in the 60s and 70s. And I think she did become a Christian. Very nice singer. She play a song, Sin Don't Live Here Anymore. And this person want it to be played. Next one. Somebody sent a message asking. But that is why we were interviewing the former Prime Minister Siaga. Somebody sent a message saying, ask him if he had mentored Mrs. Portia Simpson Miller. That is when I know them relationship. And I know that they're my sister in more than one way, politically and otherwise. The person was suggesting that to go that. But you see, in the short time that Siaga was here, 3/4 hour. There are many things that I wanted to ask. There are many things that even some people suggest. I think we're going to read some text messages about that too. Even the very next one. that we wanted to ask him about, but in a three-quarter we would not be able to get to ask him about all of those things. And he did volunteer and come here after we have made severe criticisms of him. So if him volunteer and come here, him liable for to come back here and get to ask him other things that we never get to ask him to. Next one. Jerry, why are you doing a monologue? Monologue when you alone talking. Why are you doing a monologue and not a dialogue with Mr. Siaga? We're tired to hear your voice now. Make we hear the guests for a break. Well, hear this now. I take advice and all that kind of way, but I don't take dictation. You understand me? I will take advice, but I don't take dictation. So, I'm trying to figure out if it's a dictator or a dictator to me. But me take advice on it, but not dictation. Next one. How you sidetrack pure clown, same kind of criticism, but maybe not as Cameron-ish. How you sidetrack Pinnacle and Coral Gardens and the JLP government involvement in Coral Gardens? You didn't mention the gun trade between Dudley and himself. Were you censured? I think you get cold feet. You got golden opportunity to highlight Pinnacle and Coral Gardens, Jerry. Why you overshadow Garth White, Patrick Socks? Well, here is no Patrick Socks. As I said, I never have enough time to ask him everything that I could ask him. Furthermore, in the time, worse, in the short time that we was here, I have to make the decision about what to ask him and so on. And you can talk anything about sidetrack, Pinnacle and Carl Garden. You can't make any criticism about sidetrack or run him out. Come out easy for run. And you're talking about gun trade between Dudley Thompson and himself. You know of a gun trade between Dudley Thompson and Siaga. So you are telling me to ask him things that you want to state, and you want me to state things that you want to say. So you want to have me like a puppet, and then you is a ventriloquist. And you're talking through my mouth. That's what you're living in a dream world, Patrick Socks. And you're also asking if I was censured. And I got cold feet and all kind of different thing. And you tell me about how I overshadow Garth White. Well, hear this now. Hear this now. Garth White came here on a different mission as a guest, talking about Guyana and Walter Rodney. And I invited him to come in here for a few minutes. So you can't tell if you stop living in a dream world. Living in a dream world as long as you want. You are living in a dream world where you could tell me what to do and both overshadow Garth White. At one time I think you have sense, but you're coming like you put yourself on a disguise, you know. But overshadow Garth White. I run this program for the few little minutes that I am here and will be here. And when Garth White time for run film program, him run film program. Thank you very much anyway. Let's get back to the telephone. Good morning. Welcome to Straight Up. Hello. Next one, please. Morning and welcome to Straight Up. Hello. Morning, welcome, Straight Up.
How are you doing?
Fine, thank you.
I'd like to start off with the Caribbean Court of Justice.
Yeah.
Whether or not, I don't know if it is helpful to Jamaica or not.
Yeah.
But I would refer to you to, if you remember quite well, and I know you do,
yeah,
that when the stadium were to be built, the fight that they had to build between these two political tribes, and after it was built, I think it was Norman Manley then, he couldn't even get a space to sit with the Queen when they opened it.
With the Queen, but the Queen wasn't here.
Well, the state. Well, yeah, she came down to open the,
no,
the thing, so. Anyway.
No, the Royal Box.
Yeah, the Royal Box.
I think right. It was Princess Margaret did come here. I think when you say Queen, I think you're thinking about the Royal Box, yes.
Yeah, and Manley didn't get a chance to sit in there, but he was invited to sit with other people. And then after that, the arena were built because the stadium was built enough to do it.
No, yeah. The arena was built for different purposes than the stadium. It's not that the stadium wasn't big enough. The arena is smaller than the stadium. It's built for indoor things that are done on a floor
Yeah.
And that kind of thing. Not
yeah, but the offices were built so that we could have entertainment and other things, and it was covered really for the purpose. The point I'm making, however, is that we have seen so many things. For example, the NIS. Remember when it's supposed to be going the house and pass? Remember what happened?
Yeah, what?
It was named S-I-N. Sin.
It was named S-I-N by who?
Well, by Spalding.
By which Spalding?
Tony Spalding.
Oh, yeah. And what? And therefore, what is the significance of that?
What I'm saying is that right now is the best thing Jamaica had ever seen for poor people, or people who are to live off government pension or whatever.
Yeah.
In those days, when they were coming in, they said, well, that's sin for Jamaican people, because we're not supposed to have it.
Yeah.
So the point I'm making is that these two political tribes have never been seen to agree for the development of Jamaica.
Yeah.
So we're not too sure whether or not this Caribbean Court of Justice, because they are saying that we have money in Jamaica.
Hold on a minute. You are not sure whether the Caribbean Court of Justice what?
Will be benefited to Jamaica.
Oh.
Or otherwise, as they say. Because they say we have spent so much money to send to England.
Yeah.
And there are so much injustice. You remember the state of emergency?
Yeah. Which one?
Well, the one that man put in when he locked up some of the politicians, them and all that or something. Go on.
Hold on. Yeah, you're going to discuss with me, or you're just going to finish the talk alone?
No, I'm not talking alone.
All right,
all right.
Yes, okay.
Mm-hmm.
The state of emergency that they're thinking of, I think, is 1976. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so what? So the citizens of Jamaica, outside of these two parties, what you think should be done to free the country from the tit for tat that these two parties deal with? What do you think should be done?
Well, as you know, as I do, is that almost about four or five third-party tries to come up in this country, and none of them seems to can make it. So I can't tell you exactly what we should do, because people have tried.
Yeah, okay.
And political parties.
All right, hold on a minute. There are other countries in the world, many other countries in the world, where two parties control the country for hundreds of years.
Mm-hmm.
And eventually people get from underneath that partnership. There are many countries in the world, you know, where people have got from under. You know that there are countries that have escaped out of that?
Yeah.
All right. So all we have to do is study some of those things and then get some other ideas to ourselves, because it has been done before.
Well, I don't know if you'll agree with me, that Goldin tried. If Goldin never go back
Hello, I don't think you listen to what I say. What I just said a while ago?
Repeat?
What did I say just a while ago?
No. You said other people, other country, they come out of it.
Out of what?
Out of, take themselves over these two political parties, or these two political whatever they are.
Yes, and what I said after that?
So they can try to do it.
They who can try?
People. We the people of Jamaica.
No, what you first must do is study how other people have got from under it. But you're not listening careful. But what I say, we can study how other people have got from under it. And we can add our own ideas. And it can be done. Thank you, sir.
I'll tell you it.
Call next caller, please. Good morning.
Morning again, Jerry.
Yes, how are you doing?
I believe I'm going to take a guess and say that when I text that answer, you probably have an idea anyway.
What?
When you say your friend, being ironic, the guess you had on, Mr. Siaga.
Yeah, what did you say about the friend?
No, the text was saying,
yeah, what did you say, friend?
Your friend, no, and talk about certain things on the ear.
Your old friends, oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Your old friends, I'm going to figure that's what it's about.
Oh, Mr. Siaga don't want to talk about those things, yeah. Well, I noticed when I was talking to him that he had mixed up certain dates, because I remember him writing in the 50s, 1958, about three articles in the paper pointing out certain things, including certain organizations that were leaning towards PNP and were doing certain things which shouldn't be done by civil servants. But He said that was a later time, that time Buster was active and some different thing, but I think he was mixing up the 50s with the 70s.
It sounded like that because it wouldn't correlate.
Yeah.
Wouldn't get in because he was in already.
Yeah, but my memory not as good as it used to be, so I'm not going to condemn nobody for that. But there are many things to be trashed out which cannot be avoided. But you can't do all of them in 45 minutes, you know?
Like I said, yeah, and the main thing you wanted to talk about was the Cameron thing.
Yeah, and not only that, somebody texts and... there's a text that I don't see here now. There was a text that was referring to how me ask Siaga about St. Hilda's and Cameron. And I don't see it here. I forgot to find it and bring it tomorrow. Siaga had recently written some opinion about Sentinel that I didn't even know about. So that's why I needed to address that first because of our topical subject. Furthermore, the circumstance under which he came here was my saying that I don't hear him say nothing about Cameron yet. So obviously we would discuss those things early in the discussion.
But
some people will, anybody, even myself sometimes criticize other people's action, wanting them to act more in line with how I would want them to be. So we're not really vexed about that, but the fact is that I and other people conduct them affairs, conduct them work in a way that they see best to do, which will bring out the best results, and that's what I try to do, and I don't feel no way about doing it the way I would do.
Yeah, because it might get them to talk another time, it might get some exclusive, get ready for write up. Reveal everything.
Exactly, because even though some of the things are probably all of the things that I say here sometimes upset some people and them feel like some of are tear down people, I don't really come here to try say nothing for no. I try to talk the things that are true and right, and I don't have no intention to hurt no one, but it might seem like said that, sometimes it seems that way.
And people who you talk about probably don't even upset.
Well, yes, not as much as them.
I'm probably glad that I want to get to have an interest.
Not as much as them worshippers. The worshippers more upset. I want to tell you one point or one thing before I leave, because I have to leave now.
Yeah.
There was a guy being interviewed here on Friday morning about the Peter Tosh symposium today. He's a part of the organization putting on the symposium at Curve Place, him and Paul Burke. And one of the comments he made before him left, him say, him have to laugh anytime him hear some Rasta. Him have to laugh when him consider say, every Rasta man should be a supporter of the PNP because the things that the PNP do for Rasta. No. I hear that argument now. My mind tell me say somebody tell him to come here, come say that. When I'm bigger boss, I'm telling him to come say that. I really hear that argument. Well, thank you. Thank you.
All right, man. All right.
Next one. Good morning. Morning. Welcome to Straight Up,
hello. Hello, good morning, Mr. Small.
Yes, sir, how are you doing?
Yeah, good. Happy Heroes Day.
Yeah, man, thank you.
Mr. Small, it would be good if every Jamaican could see themselves as their own hero.
Yeah.
But Mr. Small, did Marcus Garvey really say black people will not know themselves until they're back against the wall?
I don't know if there are many of the sayings attributed to Marcus Garvey which have not been dated or the occasion on which him said have not been identified. But this is what... This happens frequently with people. Not everything that them say, people go and record the date. And sometimes things that they never said have been put into their mouth. So a lady who did a lot of work in this direction is a lady named Beverly Hamilton. She identified a lot of the sayings, where they were said and when. And she also raised the topic of some of them being not being identified. But for instance, the one where him say, Africa's redemption is near at hand, and look to Africa, and when you see a black king crown, you will know that Africa's redemption is near. The occasion where him said that has not been identified, but he wrote a play about the crowning of a king in Africa, which bore all of those same sentiments in the play. And little more when Haile Selassie Tafari was crowned for the third time, it seemed to fulfill a lot of these prophecies of Marcus Garvey, and they used to be in contact in those years. So,
Mr. Small.
Yeah.
You know that every time they devalue the Jamaican dollar, it push you far away from the non-generic medicine, the true authentic medicine that you need.
I wouldn't doubt that.
I was in a pharmacy the other day. And I saw an old man coming there complaining about some pain in his back. He has been driving truck most of his life.
Yeah.
And he said the sitting, constant sitting down damaged his spine. And he saw the medicine on the shelf.
Yeah.
And when the lady tell him how much for the medicine, him just shake him head and walk out.
So him instead of have a backache alone, him have a headache now when him
yeah, don't... because him see the medicine, but it's $12,000 for it.
What the hell?
Yeah, the real non-generic medicine, because the generic medicines are not good for you, you know.
The generic one is the one where don't have no trademark or label.
Yeah, you and can't get counterfeit goods that way, you know,
them cheaper,
Small.
Yeah.
But Mr. Small, you know that Jamaican people, they think it's a collective thing that all of us back going to be against the wall one time.
Oh.
But it's an individual breakdown going on, you know, Mr. Small.
Yes.
It's like Humpty Dumpty.
Yeah.
Mr. Small, you would retire in Kingston and St. Andrew. You would retire and stay here?
If I would retire and live here?
Yeah, live in Kingston and St. Andrew.
No, I might be here, but I'm not going to stay one place.
Which section of the city would you like to retire in, Mr. Small? Cherry Gardens or below Alfred Tree?
Right beside Jinx. Side of Jinx Yard. You know Jinx?
No, Mr. Small.
The other side of Jinx Yard. Both they live one side of our yard. And, you remember Jinx?
Oh, Jinx, up Narbrook.
On Narbrook, no?
Yeah, Narbrook, very sophisticated community.
Or if it's an apartment building, I would live on the bottom floor.
Mr. Small, you know five things I noticed with Cherry Gardens.
You have to be quick. You have to be quick.
Half a tree.
Yeah, you have to be quick.
Yes, the garbage disposal in Cherry Garden is better.
Mm.
There's no lightering on the road.
Yeah.
Nobody sitting down idle on the road.
Quick, man.
And another thing I noticed is that most people up there, they have computers in their house.
Yeah.
Children is always reading ahead.
That's
and there is no nice pollution in these communities after six.
Then what Jinx did talk about nice pollution? Yeah, talk about.
No, Bolt was keeping a party, man, to build up him vibe.
You was at the party?
No, but I know friends of Bolt who attend those parties.
No, I believe you are cherry pick this thing out.
No, man, Bolt is a vibes man.
All right, thank you very much.
Yeah, motivation is key, Mr. Small. Take care.
Thank you very much, yes, sir. Fine morning. Good morning. Welcome to Straight Up, hello?
Yes, I want to talk to that brother before I go out to you. Bridging.
Which brother?
The valuation of the dollar costs everything. Here's a little thing goes by this, by Shepherd. The prices of things we buy today, out of the reach of our pay. Every day we got up, things gone up, but we have to live. We can't give it up. I won't rob my brothers, I won't rob my sister. All we got to do is make we live together.
You're using up the whole time.
No fight, no matter we
hello,
don't
you're using
we
up the
whole have to live.
Hello.
I just make it a must.
You're using up the whole time. Next point.
Well, when me ask you something, man, well, you don't love me, man. I know you alone not educate, you know, man. They educate who are listening to me, you know, brother.
You're using up the whole time.
When the Atlantic world are talking about this.
You're you using know. Up the whole time and you don't pray to Siaga yet.
No, yes, Siaga never talk about. In Quincy the other day, when he turned to you, tell him put a price on the dance at the Valley Garden. If the Minister of Finance never take him in, right now that guy would there at Jamaica right now do well, because he did only a selling like a ganja, nothing in wrong, but in Ghana, white lady, we should get the whole life people mad. So we couldn't afford that. Nothing wrong with ganja, you know. Hello?
Next call.
Nothing. Yeah,
Morning, welcome to...
Hello.
Welcome.
Good morning.
Good morning, welcome.
Mr. Small.
Yes, ma'am.
Paul Vogel was led by the British puppet, you know, I mean, not puppet, I mean, oppressor. They were the oppressor then. But then now, the British are using the black race now, or you could say the House of Parliament, as a puppet against each other, against the black race. In those days, it was the black against the white. I mean, the white against the black. Now it's the black against their own black, their program, like a computer. I wonder if you know that.
So they never use the maroon against Bogle?
The maroon?
Yeah.
No, did they?
Yes, man.
Well, to a certain extent, yeah, but what I'm saying is now, the House of Parliament and even the people on the street now, what is it in Jamaica really going on? Isn't it a black, what do you call it, war against each other? Against some of us?
I agree with you that the local government, the government here is playing the same role. Like what, them playing the same role on behalf of the, on behalf of the money people, the property people, and the, and the, and the.
Right. Yeah. In Africa, when they were catching the black slaves, it was little, pretty buttons, you know. They were taking their trinkets. So it's not everything that glitters is gold. So now they can program, or some of us. I mean, it's so simple, it's so easy to get carried away by a few dollars, a few thousand dollars. And that is what they're doing. I mean, so many people should not be dying from our own, the hands of their own brothers and sisters.
All right, so some steps that people can take, talk about that now.
Some steps that they can take.
No, not they. People. There's some steps that people can take. The same people who say have been foolish before. Some steps that they can take. What?
Pray more.
What?
Pray more, as I said, and it works. And the crime, and I mean the House of Parliament. Don't take them as God, because they're not God. Because the Bible said, if my people which are called by my name would humble themselves and pray and seek my face,
all right,
and change from the wicked ways, I would hear from heaven.
All right, thanks. Off we go.
Just a minute. That's what we talk about. That you're gone.
No. We have to try put on that one on the list, and people give a report on how effective it will be.
It is effective.
I have to go now. Thank you very much. Call again. You have some time. Can call. We have more than an hour and a half again. Call again here. Welcome back to Straight Up. I'm your host, Jerry Small. We are on the 19th of October today. Public holiday, but you know, work as usual on public holiday. Holidays, we're going to get back to the telephone in a while, but we have Kwasi, who is a frequent guest here. And last time we were talking about the neglect of civics and certain education, you know. But anyway, since that time, the Kwasi, how are you doing?
Give thanks.
Yeah, you just tell me that you get some good response since the last time I see, but if you care to talk about that, or we just use the time and tell us what your plan are, what more can be done in the ideas that you were talking about, the CCC, what name again?
Oh, the CCC.
Are you talking about something different?
Well, what I wanted to do this morning was to start out with honoring, you know, the people who fought for us.
Yeah.
All the heroes, sung and unsung, the named and unnamed. And I wanted to do that by just calling the years that we had serious rebellion against the slave system in Jamaica.
Yeah.
And even after the slave system, of course, with Bogle. So I just want to go through a list of the years so that we can see how frequent these rebellions were, and we can gauge from them, from the past, what our level of activity could be. Then I want to go from that into a review of our history since the English took over this country. From a certain point of view that I think will be quite helpful in understanding our own situation today. So it's a kind of Sankofa, looking back in order to go forward with the wisdom of the past, you know. And I also would like to briefly, if I have time, to speak a bit about George William Gordon, who I think is not adequately song in our society today, and I don't think many people know much about him, and therefore I think he's underappreciated, and I think there's much to be said about George William Gordon.
Am I off 25 minutes?
Okay then. So to honor all our heroes who fought and fell, not only while in custody, so their names are known, but also on the battlefield. So most of their names are not known. They fell not only on the battlefield, but they fell also in the depredations of the British militia and the local militiamen when they were taking their revenge during all of this time. The British established Jamaica as a slave colony in 1655. And they were the first serious rebellion, and only the serious ones are recorded. And I don't have all the names of where they were who were involved, so I concentrate mainly on the years. 1678, we had the first serious rebellion. This was followed by in 1684, then 1886 in Chapelton, Clarendon, 1690 again in Chapelton, 1691. So for the first less than half a century that the British were here, there were 5 rebellions over that time. Going to the next century, in 1717, there was a serious rebellion. And in 1722, there was an even more serious one in which they imported what they call mosquito Indians, I think from Florida, to help suppress that rebellion. Then in 1734, there was a rebellion in Nanaytown. And what we must know is that the attacks against the slave system were both from slaves on the plantation and from Maroons coming from the hills. So I include all of these struggles because they were attacks against the system of slavery. In 1738, there was Kodjo. In 1739, there was Kwako in Chulani. In 1740, there was another serious rebellion, followed by 1746. In 1758, again, a serious rebellion in Trelawney. In 1760, Tacky led that action, originating in St. Mary. In 1765, there were the Coromantes were involved in a serious rebellion. Then in 1776, there was a very serious rebellion in Westmoreland, so that in 1777, they had 30 executions. In 1782, Three Finger Jack terrorized the British society in Jamaica, operating, I think, out of the east of Kingston, I think in the Rockford Hills, and possibly in the Palisades, which were islands at that time. In 1795, there was the Trelawney Maroons uprising. And in 1796, there was also the Maroon War. Now, surprisingly, these were occurring after the treaty was signed. In 1798, there was the action that involved Coffey, who was not one of our heroes, I don't think, because he was involved, I think, in the death of Nanny. But that could be corrected. So in the 18th century, that is the 1700s, there were 15 serious uprisings, rebellions, or what they sometimes call riots. But all these were aimed at the slavery system of slavery here. And essentially they were aimed at the plantations and the systems of local government. In the 19th century, there were only 2 serious rebellions, but these were very, very transformative. There was Sam Sharp-led rebellion in 1831-32, and then there was the Bogle Rebellion in 1665. Since that time, we have not had a serious rebellion. In 1938, we had labor unrest with the objectives of improving the standard of living. Now, all the rebellions, in my opinion, up to, but not including the Bogle Rebellion, were actions being taken against plantation system. And when the British came here, they established a slave economy and a slave, an administration, what you could call a slave colonial system, political system. So there were institutions, economic institutions established, that was the plantation were the units, and together they constitute the plantation system, and people who own them form what was called the plantocracy. This is the economic institution of slavery. Political institution of slavery had two parts. There was the national part, which was consisted of two councils or departments, the Legislative Council and the House of Assembly. And of course, when it was established, only the slave owners could qualify to vote for or to enter into the House of Assembly. The Legislative Council was an appointed council, much like our Senate. So these rebellions that attacked plantation system was actually attacking the economic institution of slavery, because this is what slavery was set up for, the plantation, to make money, business, the economic institutions. And this was all these struggles against the plantation system culminated in the Sam Sharp Rebellion, in which we was followed by the abolition of slavery. We do acknowledge that there were favorable conditions given the division between the industrialists and the merchants in England and their representatives in the UK Parliament. But nevertheless, the Sam Sharp Rebellion was the final blow against the economic institutions of slavery. However, the political institutions of slavery survived and became more rabid after the abolition of slavery. And this was what led to the Bogle Rebellion. Now, to understand the Bogle Rebellion in the context of institutions, you must realize that the action of Bogle had two aspects. One was trying to address the governor, that is a national, and he took action locally in St. Thomas in the East against the local government there. Now, the structure of local government is very interesting. There were 22 parishes organized for local government, and in each parish, they had a rector and a rectory. So what was happening was the church and state formed the local government in the country. And the center of the offices of the local government was in fact located in what is called the rectory, which is the premises of the rector, who is the head of the parish church. There was a parish church in each parish, and that was part of the state system. So in that rectory, you had two sides. You had the manse, where the rector lived with his servants and slaves and family, and you had the vestry, which were offices. And in these offices, you had the offices of the rector, but also you had the offices of the elected members of the local government. They were called vestrymen, and they had different responsibilities. For example, there were church wardens. There were wardens in charge of roads and ways, and wardens in charge of canals and waterways, and so on. So in this context here, George William Gordon was also elected as a church warden on more than one occasion. So in Bogle's action on the day, the 11th of October, 1865, was an attack against the local government system and the judiciary in St. Thomas in the East. So therefore, it was not a riot, as it is called too much in the history, because a riot doesn't occur by people attacking first the place to get the arms and to release prisoners, who may then add to your forces, and then to attack the vestrymen who fled into the courthouse and were all killed. There's another head in the local government, which was the custos, of course. I don't know if it was purely titular, but he was the one who gave the order to fire, and he was also killed. Subsequent to the Bogle Rebellion, they disestablished the Anglican Church, which had been established in here, in Jamaica, since 1655. They also abolished the House of Assembly and the Legislative Council, and in so doing, the whole political institution of slavery was finally abolished years after the economic institutions of slavery were abolished. And this was the real achievement of the Bogle Rebellion, which I don't think is fully understood. Bogle's Rebellion did not win political power, but certainly abolished the political institution of slavery, which was enforced in 1655. So consequently to that, the British, advised by the Starks Commission, there was a man called Stark, who just like the man called Moyne, led a commission looking into the happenings of 1665. And Stark apparently recommended the modernization of the state, of the colonial state in Jamaica. So we have prisons being built, GP, as mental asylums being constructed, Bellevue, and in fact, under slavery, there was no need for these institutions because you have a slave that was useless, whether bad or for mental purposes, you were simply eliminated. So these were new institutions in a general sense here. And they also had also different changes. The British also established direct rule, I think this is called Crown Colony, to continue. So the next collective action of our people happened in 1938. As I said, it was a labor unrest generally, but it's very general in the country. And some were frightening enough to cause them to send out another commission, the Moyne Commission, who made certain recommendations. And those recommendations are still, were put into place starting 1944 with internal self-government, under which the British were able to identify prospective political leaders and to probably guide them into organizing themselves into two parties, which now could form a bipartisan committee to draft a constitution in 1960-61, so or thereabouts, that led to a constitution called the Jamaica Constitution being brought into force in the UK Parliament. So the action of 1938 led to institutional changes that are in place today in Jamaica. And what came along with that was that two parties were established in the process. And those two parties are the only two parties that are very active since that time. So we can see that the action of institutional change by the British has been very long standing. The Moyne Commission of 1938 made certain recommendations which were accepted by the Colonial Office of the UK government and have led to our constitution, which is still in force today, and therefore has led to the basis of foundation of all our political institutions which are in force today. So essentially, all of this which is happening in the sphere of the political institutions were created by, conceived by Moyne and his commission since 1938 and are still in effect. Now the importance of this is that when we examine what are our social and economic condition, we wonder what is the driving force behind it. And we often think that it is in the sphere of party politics and electioneering. And we expect to get better for the society and for ourselves through this, through involvement in these activities. But what we realize is that politics has many ups and downs, many changes of regime, changes of leadership, changes of representations and representatives. But the social condition and economic conditions appears very constant as compared to the rapid changes in the political sphere. And one has to wonder if politics really drives social change, or is it a mere illusion, an ephemera that distracts from the real drivers of social change. I put it to you that just as the British political institutions instituted slavery in Jamaica by means of granting large lands of tracts and import and establishing the slave trade, and the slave trade is the other important economic institution of slavery along with the plantation. So what they did created to the British political institution that created economic institutions of slavery in Jamaica and the economic institution of the slave trade. So we see that political institutions create economic institutions. For example, in Jamaica, recently in 2012, we saw that when the government, with the advice of the IMF, had threatened or was in a threatening position to the interests of the financiers who had large quantities of government bond in their possessions, the financiers insisted upon an institution that they were to be involved in, and in fact to co-chair, which is called the EPOC, Economic Program Oversight Committee, as their guarantee of no further such threats occurring to them in the future. So the businessmen, the financiers, have seen the importance of creating an institution, not in law, but in fact, to safeguard their future interests. They know the importance of institutions. In Jamaica, people are looking for the vote to make changes. And as I said, we have not seen any changes. And as it has been said, to expect change by repeating the same action is a sign of insanity. We need to see that in Jamaica, our situation derives from economic institutions which are exclusive. That is, there are few people who benefit very much. Our statistics show that their top 20% have increased in their share of income over the last few years, whereas the bottom 80%, all the bottom 80%, including doctors, as you can see, the public service doctors, their income has fallen. And we must stop, look at the political game created by the Moyne Commission, and start to look at the institutions which persist and which are causing the persistence of our economic stagnation and the persistence of our social decline. I'd like to take the remaining minutes to look at George William Gordon. He was the son of a planter and a slave, so therefore he was a black man, because we accept the white man's definition that if you have one drop of blood, you are black, but only if that person wants to be accepted as being black. So he was the son of a planter and a slave who taught himself to read, write, and to do accounts. And by being able to do accounts, he was able to earn money, and to the point that he bought his freedom. He not only bought his freedom, but he also bought the freedom of his sisters. And on top of that, sent them to Europe for their education, because of course there was no avenue for blacks to get educated in Jamaica formally. Eventually, he also aided his impoverished white father to return to England when he was quite old. But because he was not in the legitimate family of his father, he was not allowed to go to see him off, even though he was paying for the trip. Just imagine that. He married a white woman, and he encouraged his white friends who accepted him, because probably of his high color, but probably more of his high character, to support the causes of the blacks. He initiated in the House of Assembly an inquiry into the expenditure of funds to the rector of St. Thomas in the East. So the House of Assembly is the national body of representatives. So he's bringing up a motion in the House of Assembly against the rector, that is the pastor of the Anglican Church in St. Thomas of the East, on a contract for repairs to the rectory. He took a resolute stand against rectors, that is, these parish priests and curates. I don't know what that is exactly. I feel it's some office within the Anglican Church. Being on building committees for the repairs of churches and chapels, he said, quote, "Some of these gentlemen are of doubtful character, and I have very little confidence in them, in many of them. In some parishes, rectors and curates are contractors, And instead of looking after their spiritual matters, are repairing parochial buildings. Gordon was a church warden in St. Thomas in the East. One Rector Cook moved a motion in the circuit court to remove him since he was not a communicant of the Church of England. I think he was Baptist. The charges against Gordon were after the Bogle Rebellion were those of high treason and of inciting murder and rebellion. If we look at the governor's dispatch, we see that we read that having placed Mr. Gordon on board the Wolverine and having obtained a supply of arms and ammunition from General O'Connor for the use of the Maroons and others, the Wolverine was the ship that they took him that went from, I think, Kingston to Morant Bay. Now there was a certain correspondent of a paper called the Colonial Standard, Mr. Lake, who have made very revealing records of what happened. Now he wrote twice, during the state of emergency and after it was removed. This is what he wrote during the state of emergency. After William Gordon had been brought ashore, that is in Morant Bay, he was taken to the station, and the scene presented is hardly describable. From one blue jacket, now the blue jacket are the army members, the soldiers. From one blue jacket you could hear, quote, "Which is the venerable Parson Gordon?" From another, "There he is," pointing to Gordon. From a third, I'll set the bloody dogs at you, you rascal. From a fourth, "I will tear you up myself." From the next, "What is he, a white man?" From another, "You won't be long here, we'll soon string you up." And other exclamations which hardly be the thing to put to papers. He was given a very patient trial, and this is continuing, quoting from the report, during the state of emergency. He was given a very patient trial and was allowed to cross-examine all the witnesses, though the president of the court, and above all, was permitted, through the president of the court, of the court, and above all, was permitted to enter a lengthy defense. I have full notes of the trial, but I am not allowed to forward them for publication until leave is given by me, by the Brigadier General. So that was the transmission during the state of emergency.
Welcome back to Straight Up into the third hour of the program. Today is 19th of October, Monday 19th of October. The Heroes Day, where they are a card in the memory of Peter Toshude and of Oje. And afterward, they're having a symposium at Curfew Place, 1 o'clock. 1 o'clock, they're having a symposium at Curfew Place, $500 to go in. Paul Burke, I think, is the chairman, his wife, and several academics and members of Peter Tosh family, and including Omar Davis, not as a member of Peter Tosh family, but as one of the academics. $500, 1 o'clock. Alan Cole also will be speaking. 1 o'clock at the Curfew Place. Curfew Place, that is near the library, near Oxford Road, Tom Redcorn Avenue. Yes, I'm going to get back to the, before I get to the phone. Several other people, like I meet over the weekend, from Friday come right down, this is a long weekend. Brandy, bridging from African Gardens, Brandy down in Augustown, the African Gardens, one of the nearby neighbors of Dimples. You know, Dimples is one of the young ladies who a friend of Straight Up and come from down the same Grizz close there in Augustown. So yeah, yell Brandy and Dimple from Grizz close, and also from Spanish Town, Michael Francis. He's an artist, Michael Francis, and his mother also listen to Straight Up. I in Bart is her name. Appreciate them very much. I hope them have time to be listening on. Hope them don't just listen to the beginnings of the program, because this is 2 hours after the program start. But anybody know them, tell them that we heard them yelling them. Michael Francis, the artist from Spanish Town, and his mother, Hyacinth Bart. Hyacinth Bart from Spanish Town. Yell David, our brethren, David Nyack, down at Bryce Hill Road also, and them brethren that we had a good reasoning with. man, David, down at Bryce Hill Road, Taylor man named David Naya. And there is Miss Maureen Ray. Miss Maureen Ray. These people I met at Mr. Brown's funeral yesterday. Most of them is most of these people are Bull Bay people. Maureen Ray from Dumfries Crescent and License. Yeah, dressmaker, yes man. And next lady named Joan Cole from Bull Bay. Joan Cole from Bull Bay. And I'm listening straight up to Rima Robinson in Bull Bay also, and Audrey Myers, 11 miles Bull Bay. Also Mabel Simpson and Sula and Gail. Mabel Simpson and Sula and Gail. All of them Bull Bay, and Bonnie from 10 miles in Bull Bay. Mrs. Laurie and Mattox, Mrs. Murray and Mattox in Bull Bay. Also Claude Robinson from 11 miles and Robert Jacobs. Claude Robinson and Robert Jacobs. And Robert Jacobs, they listen to straight up all the way. He's also a correctional officer also. And Jennifer Brown, one of the daughters of Mr. Brown. One of the daughters of Mr. Brown that always phoned this program here. And Charmaine Martin. Charmaine Martin, the mother of Daniel U. Martin. She's another... No, this is the next lady. Her son is a second-year law student at the university. Also, minister who has a church down in Moy Hall, one of the missionary churches down in Moy Hall. Moy Hall and Welcome and Lapland down in St. James there, near to Cambridge and near to Cambridge and what's the next place there again? Forget that district there down in Cambridge. But it's Moy Hall, and he's a minister of the church, Mr. Arthur Plowright. Long time colleague of Mr. Reverend Green. Was out there, so. At the send-off of Sam Green. There are some more. I don't want to miss any of them. Where are they? I'll find them in time. But thank you very much, and we have a telephone, we have some more calls there, we'll get back to the telephone. We can't take any more text messages today, we'll get back to the telephone. Good morning and welcome to Straight Up, hello?
Welcome.
What going on, sir?
All right. In came Friday.
Eh?
In came Friday.
What are you talking about the past Prime Minister?
And he, according to you, was to spend half hour and spend 45 minutes.
Yes.
I'm glad you never let go my friend funds him.
Which friend that?
God.
Well, God, yes. Well, God, let go God pun him, yes, but...
No, you're easy. No, listen. Hold on. Curfew place down Swallowfield behind the police station.
Swallowfield, yeah.
All right.
Up there,
now, you know Jackie Bell?
Yes, man.
You know Howie Bell?
You mean the late Jackie Bell?
You know Howie Bell?
Yes, sir, yes.
And you know Neville Bell?
Yes, man.
Them have function out of Nazi to the top.
Oh yes, is it a football match?
Alright.
Bell and Zeddy, Jackie Bell and
Alright.
Jackie Bell and what's the first name again? Forget Zeddy the ball of first name.
You know where you said, man, because you just said something a while ago.
Yes.
And your memory is like about 10 and 9.
Oh yeah?
Yeah man. Now there was another brother around on the question there, you see?
Yeah.
Wait. Gart and him was friend, and you was being friend too.
Yeah.
And Bob Marley and them was friend. He married to a singer with cancer. What him name?
Married to a singer. And she died? Or she alive? She alive? Or she live?
Me don't know if she dead yet.
Married to a singer. What does he do? What him do otherwise?
Then I used to sit around with Gart and all of them, man. In a music business with Bob Marley and all of them.
Yeah, I can't really think of who that is.
All right, the next time I call you, I'm going to remember his name and tell you who. Okay?
Yeah, you know Winston Service?
Maybe.
Oh, them used to sing with them. What? I think it's Derek Harriott group, the Jiving Juniors are one of them groups.
All right. Derek Harriott uncle is who?
Remind me again.
Not a politician.
Remind me who again?
Andy Nicholson, one of them.
Who?
AJ Nicholson.
Oh yeah. But
all right.
Yeah, well, you have some uncle younger than the Navy, but.
Yeah, but let me ask you something, Jerry.
Yeah, Jermaine, you're younger than Derek already, yeah.
Let me ask you this. You can remember the days of Hope Garden, when all the band then played?
Yep.
Military band?
Yeah, man.
Band?
Yeah, man. Band concert Sunday.
Okay. And you have a top stand and a bottom stand?
Yeah, the gazebo, them bandstand.
Okay. Now,
police band.
All right. You can remember the police band name?
West India Regiment.
All right. Regiment band. All right. Now, all those days, all right. You just don't talk about some people, the pastor, okay?
Yeah.
And what do you mean you talk about Mr. Brown?
Yeah.
Where did they not go there? Where you so work with the insurance company?
Yes, yes, yes. Him have an agency out there.
Yeah.
And him leave it to him son.
All right. You all right?
Yes, sir. Thank you very much.
You're season, huh?
All right. Thank you very much, yeah.
You're going to have function them tonight?
Quite likely.
Argument done.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much.
Those are word.
Yes, sir. Yeah, man, Mr. Henry Brown is the man we were called Mr. Buckner, buried yesterday out there. I mean, the funeral yesterday, memorial out of 10 Mile would be. Good morning, welcome to Straight Up, hello.
Good morning, Mr. Mom.
Yes, sir, welcome.
Wonderful presentation, by the way.
Yes, yes, sir.
I enjoyed. Mr. Gordon, did you have any children?
Which one? Are you, George William Gordon? I think so, you know. I have a book I can tell you, but I can't go in it right now. I can't remember, but I think he may have children.
He alluded that he was half black and half white.
Who alluded that?
What the question about William Gordon and that?
Them father was father a white man and his mother was a black woman, yes. African.
Yeah, I enjoy spending the last card. Thanks.
No, you talk too fast. What you say?
I just can't say I enjoy his presentation.
Okay, yes, yes. Kwasi, yes, okay. Thank you very much. Next call again. Good morning.
Hello.
Yeah, welcome.
How you doing?
Fine, thank you.
Yeah, boy, I'm here. I'm listening today's holiday and nothing else now going on. You're the only little entertainment and you bring on a little boring brother from pull up the show.
Boring?
If people want to know them something, man, they can't read and go read it on internet just like him, man.
No, he wasn't reading something. He only a little bit reading him, did he? He was talking.
Yeah, man. You know, them,
you know, listen,
you
know,
yeah. People want to know them, can research themselves.
If you want...
I got the only little entertainment today, and you know what I mean? Just to switch off, you know?
So you regard this program as entertainment?
For the most time.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Yeah, man, a bit of a boring bad man.
Yeah.
Bad.
And that's what you call for, say?
Yeah, you know what I mean? Because nothing else now going on. And, you know, me, I listen to it and thing, and then you hear him come out, I have to just switch, you know?
Yeah.
So yeah, anyway, thank you.
What you must talking, hold on, what you must talking about?
But about you know, George William Gardner, and them, you know, you learn them to sort of fire.
The things that he was talking about is not things that written in a book.
Yeah, my man. I read them, do some research and come and read it. Anybody can do that.
So you know history, right?
I need somebody to come and read something to me.
Where you are here?
Can research it myself.
Yes, yes. All right, thank you very much.
Nobody want to know, can research themselves.
Give me a next call. Thank you, sir. Next one. Good morning. Welcome to Straight Up, hello.
Yeah, morning again, Jeff.
Wagwan.
Yeah, Kwasi.
Yeah.
Dennis Zeri, yeah.
Dennis Zeri, yeah. Dennis.
The Mosquito Indians, I think them was from Nicaragua.
Yeah, no, Mosquito, yeah.
And the cost us in a bogle time.
Van what?
Van Kettlewolt.
Yeah, one German. Van Kettlewolt.
Yeah. But from what Kwasi did I say, you see, it helped me to understand why the violence is how it is in Jamaica.
Yeah. When you read, yes, man. When you read some of the things from that time, it come like the exact same people you know with the same problems and frustration.
Yeah, because people them, especially the youth them, want space to be,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And it's like them being crowded in and else, them have to rise up.
Yeah.
So, while we are bust your brain now about the violence and what we keep it done, the thing is, we have to cut out the corruption and the dishonesty and the oppression. You know?
Yeah.
You them want space. Right? You them nowadays and, you know, them just crowded in, the classism.
Yeah. A land them take and define the classes in a land.
Yeah.
Property.
Yeah. Yeah, man. Go to and land and space.
Yeah. And the Indian and Chinese community largely escape this land, this class restriction because them come here of them own free will and them consolidate and hold land, them hold land more, you know.
Whole land and property.
Yeah, them coming off a deal. Although, meanwhile, they must come in here upon that farm work deal, you know. England have robbed them land in India.
Yeah.
Raped them and robbed them land in India same time, you know.
Yeah.
But at least the rest of them people are still living in the land. And them some of them return and, you know, them eventually overthrow. India is a huge country.
Yeah, man.
As against Africa, that is many different nations and countries, several different ones. But India was a huge country. Well, one of the reasons, many different countries and provinces, you know, hundreds. But the big Indian, them, the rich Indian and the so-called royal family Indian, them, combined those countries of it as them property. Yeah. So after a while, it become a country instead of many hundreds of different provinces and nations.
Yeah, well, them call them the Maharaj.
Maharaj and Mughal, all kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, yes, sir.
Yeah, man, give that.
Morning, and welcome to Straight Up Along.
Indeed, Brother Jerry.
Wagwan.
This frequency on this side of the island, Manchester, St. Elizabeth, has taken a nosedive.
Oh, yeah.
Fortunately, I managed to find a piece of technology on the net that caused me to hear the program today.
Yeah.
Tell them to take it up off its nose and let it stand on its feet.
What piece of technology do you use?
What them call this thing, you know, it's actually a mobile device, you know?
Oh.
Yes, with where you go on the net.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I tried Google, and I tried a thing they call Brian's Caribbean Radio.
Oh.
The Jamaica version. Mm-hmm. I will put a thing on the net, Jerry.
I know.
Talking about all the things on the net, Jerry. You know, so the internet can be a dangerous place for children. And many children are using the internet without any guidance.
Most of them, yeah.
Yes, and when them go on the net, a whole heap of shaving cream, they might come up on, you know.
Not only them go on there and buck it up, but they are drafted into the internet to and put on display. Some of the same children find themselves on display, on the internet, and on sale, on market.
Absolutely. It's a serious thing. No, Jerry, I don't
hey, hold on. Before you go further.
Yes.
You have slave market. I go on long time all in Westmoreland. Westmoreland, St. Elizabeth, according to Go-Go, some little young girl with them a buy. And not only that, I remember about 20 years or more ago.
Yes.
In the Orchard area, right now the market area there, in the Orchard, right in the middle of town.
Yes.
People had some little girls on sale there, and if a man want a 11-year-old girl to play with him, he can contact people in the market and them go find her, give him and take money and all them where them rent them out.
What did you say to me?
For years ago, them things are going on. Police know.
Yes.
Police know the whole of them thing, and police look the other way. Sometimes them push them on one way and look the other way.
Oh my gosh. You believe there's an increase in these incidents these days?
Yes.
By the way, you know, a 20-year-old man in Trinidad meet a bitter end, you know, last week. They say he has been having what you could call a cozy relationship with a 14-year-old girl.
Mm-hmm.
Police had intervened, but they didn't have any solid evidence on him. And they want him to stay away from her, but he continued to meet her on a beach.
Mm-hmm.
Well, some residents decided to take matters into their own hands, and he got the sharp edge of their cutlasses.
All right.
As a matter of fact, when I hear that story, it reminds me of you telling us a story some time ago about a certain individual when your daughter was going to school who saw her as a low-hanging fruit. and he showed up at a certain location where he wanted to meet her.
No, hear me now. Not, I don't want my daughter to be taken as a little puppy show and a little...
No, man.
Well, allow me, please, to finish.
Indeed.
Yes.
Yes.
A male teacher, like many male teachers at school, them organize outing and try to entice away girls. Thank you very much. Next call.
Indeed.
Good morning. Welcome to Straight Up, hello.
I'm there. Good morning.
Yes, ma'am. How are you doing, ma'am?
Good morning to Jamaicans everywhere. Good morning to my beautiful island home, Jamaica, the paradise of the Caribbean, third of the Caribbean. Good morning to me. God continue to bless the Jamaica. You know, Jerry, I never knew that Mr. Brown died.
Mr. Brown, you know him?
No, but what is the other name you call him?
Mr. Henry Brown.
Not Brown, not the other name.
You mean Buckner? Yeah.
Right? Because I couldn't understand that man. You know, it was St. Andrew. Used to be a labor JNP constituency for many, many years. Right, and it's changing up when Damon became the member of parliament for that place. He kept calling on Damon all the time, Damon Crawford, to do this and do that out in Bolivia, the center out there, needed the stairs and all sorts of stuff, and needed computer and all kinds of stuff. And he would call every day, sometimes twice per day, he would call Damon Crawford.
Yeah.
And for many, many years, he threw a St. Andrew, was in a terrible condition. It wasn't like that because I've been up there, as I said, I have family living in the area. I would go up there sometimes and do these breakaways. Sometimes you'd be afraid to drive on the road up there with the breakaways. And the road was always so bad and the condition, the constituents were in a terrible, terrible state. Right? And now little young Damon, may God bless him, he came along and was under this pressure from everybody. The weight upon his shoulders was giving basket to carry water in that place. And he tried his best, you know? And, but you know, all I have to say to them and press on, my darling, press on, because God above knows that you have done the best and will continue to do your best for Jamaica, right? And once God is in the ship called Jamaica, right, you'll anchor safely in the harbor.
All right, thank you very much, Gemma.
All right, okay. Yeah.
Next one, please. Good morning. Welcome.
Hello. Good morning, Jerry.
Hey, how about?
Hi there. All of us want to be near Jinx. All aspire to Norbrook.
Yeah.
Tommy Cowan.
Yeah.
With the name, the gentleman, was surgeon.
Oh, yes. A true man.
Musician who know Marley and cricket and Marley and Carlin Davis.
A true. But his wife, his previous wife died, and I think maybe that is the one who... That's the one who might have had cancer, previous
okay.
wife.
Okay, Carleen actually did have a challenge with I think, breast cancer, you know.
Oh, yeah?
Yes, man, Carleen, she overcame it, something.
Yeah, you remember my previous wife, though? She was in the music business, and,
I don't remember her, but
yeah.
Maybe if I get the name, you know, might ring a bell. Actually called to put up 1 minute assessment on your thing with Saga on Friday. It reminds me of, there are 150 Psalms in the Bible. And Psalm 1, you know, it just come to mind. Blessed is the man, walketh not, courseth ungodly, standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. Mr. Siaga sitting in the seat of News of Straight Up,
mm-hmm.
News Talk 93 FM,
yeah.
is a testament to the truthfulness and the purity, the integrity of your program. Because if it was not a program of such integrity, I don't think he would have entertained, you know. I mean, a hour in your life at this time is a very important thing, you know.
Yeah.
I sum it up in a cricketing term. I call it a good over. A nice, tidy over.
Mm. Or a session.
Yes.
You know, the session between lunch and tea and all of them, you know, you have different
things. Yes, man, it's over that demand, you have to get the ball again. You know, when I'm the captain, get man a ball and him bowl a good over,
oh, yeah.
You have to get that second over. There were no wides.
Or a spell, a bowling spell, yes.
Yes, man, no wides, no ball.
Oh.
Nothing down the leg side.
Uh-huh.
And you, in fact, you're slipping a nice bouncer there. Quick pace and steep rising.
Uh-huh.
Yes, man.
Which one, that?
When you asked him about the photograph in the Rima,
Yeah, yeah.
With Desmond McKenzie and reputed
Fernet. Yeah, yeah.
And he joked it out by saying perhaps we should not drink the beer. But he had explained that time it was for a good cause.
He was
able to curtail violence and possibly loss of life.
Yes, but he also curtailed, I think it in effect, it also curtailed from police investigations and the course, what you call it, the law must take it course.
And that's why I had to
ask him if Jim Brown wasn't above the law, because although he says that Jim Brown was charged at one time. If he even charged 10 times, that would be 10 in 10,000.
Yeah, so that's why I'm calling on the abong, sir. But if but well, you know.
He was a wicket keeper, you know that?
Yes, man, at Wilmers.
No, not only Wilmers, all school wicket keeper. I think he was all school wicket keeper.
The
all
school team?
No, he was a wicket keeper when he was 16. Eh?
Yes, man. So I really have to put it in the category with the Never Will Be Bob Marley, with the Monty Perkins Ninja Man, and with the Monty Perkins Renato Adams. By the way, I would love if you find out from Miss Adams, if you can talk to him one day, what became of that research he was doing on his name, because he said he was researching what's his exact name. And I didn't hear anything from that.
All right, next time. Here, sir.
Yeah, man.
Next one. Good morning. Welcome to Straight Up, hello.
Gary, how are you doing, man?
Fine.
My brother. I appreciate the last call, eh?
Yeah.
And with the let me so say that thing, eh? Whether it was a bounce or a googly, we start offend it off, like, certain way, you know?
Yeah.
And defend himself. And you yourself even said to him, well, him should have known that. That's no secret. That, look, I have been very critical of you, Mr. Seaga, at certain times when whatever. And nothing wrong with that. You understand?
Mm.
Because so many other journalists can be critical of so many other people. One call coming before, when my brother said, well, if you not, like, do something else, give some entertainment and blah, blah, blah.
Mm-hmm.
Remember me listen to you one time, Jerry, and a long time I listened to that station. I used to listen to our next station, then I come to this station. I don't really change my thing the more than so. I just never listen to a sporting event, so my radio does escape on the station. And to me, I stand to be corrected, but I doubt it very much. You have set a precedent where on holiday, I don't know if no other talk show hosts work or any talk show program work on a holiday. Every holiday we come up with, you're there.
Mm.
So, and it's a breath of fresh air, somebody you do, you know, holidays are normal. You know, sitting with a car and bus and nothing, you're sitting and you listen to some conversation, whatever, whichever way. And, you know, so I don't know, to each his own, so like, you can't force nobody to say or do whatever. But sometimes I'm catching the one song there. And finally, when I came up there Thursday, it was really a nice, a breath of fresh air, man. A lot of people were there, a mingling, a talk, pictures taken. We meet Fox. Fox a good boy, you know.
Yeah,
when you, yeah, you know, talk to him. And, you know, Fox have some problems, you know.
Yeah.
Health-wise, but it's not a man who talk about it. So we have to just respect that and see what we can do in the future, if there is anything can be done, you know.
Yeah, support and encourage, man.
Yes, what you mean, man, because the older one will go up and look. When I look at Gartway, I've heard him before, but I've never seen him.
Yeah.
Oh, one simple little man, you know.
Simple looking, yes.
And him powerful, look how the words with him, when him attack on our show. Powerful words, and where you look. And one little rasta man.
Mm.
You know, and so many other people were there, a regular, everyday, ordinary people. And we meet and greet each other, so them things they only tell us more how we can socialize and how we can do things out there, go out there, without, because some people, you know, some of the bad boys them nowadays in the community, music carry a few of them go karaoke.
Yeah, but quick, we're on another time.
Yeah, I know. And when we come, Mr. Ratted, Sarge, please, nice man.
Yeah.
Tell them, say, boy, look, you have to go to no more. Simple as that.
Thank you very much.
Yes, respect, my friend.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Next one. Good morning.
Due to unfavorable financial condition. I am unable to cope with this financial situation. It's causing inflation and creation. I can't stand this no longer. The wicked get stronger. Now that you waited till your back is against the wall, one step to progress, my brother, and I know Jah will help you all. And them have to get a beating, Lord. They must get a beating, yeah. Them have to get a beating.
Welcome back to Straight Up. I'm here with Jerry Small today. 19th of October, Euros Day, hello. Morning, welcome to... No, not there? Oh. Yeah. I didn't intend to bring the Gleaner, you know. Cause some interesting things. In yesterday, Gleaner as usual, and Sunday, Gleaner. But I didn't bring it anyway. The female... taxi driver. This might be stale to you, but it's still interesting to me. Especially because so many others of the taxi community. And at first I didn't hear that this was a taxi operator. I just heard there was a lady parking her car. Park and sit down in her car. A nice car too. It was one of them big Toyota like a Mark II or something like that. Anyway. So many other people don't probably never operate in the same way. I wasn't fortunate enough to get the legal representation. I never get awarded 10.4 million in damages because of the way how them conduct themselves. But fortunately for this lady, she get, well, I hope she will be paid. Let's get back to the telephone. Good morning, welcome. Straight up, hello.
Morning.
Morning, sir, welcome.
How are you doing,
fine, thank you. Are you secure to this?
Yeah. My program reached a milestone, man. Yeah. That's the I got on the program.
Oh, yes.
Sure, man. That's a good man.
Yeah.
This man, in the first day when your daughter come there, this yeah. man, you interview him too, man.
Which one?
Remember the man, come from down at Johnstone. Eh?
Oh, you must
tell that man to know about the music, man.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
I remember.
What a nice interview that, you know?
I remember that, yes.
Yeah, remember the man in here.
Yes, I remember.
And the lens. And the name to me about, I never know the same job out.
Yeah, man, Henry Brown, yeah.
Henry Brown, yeah.
I'm our great family, may I tell you, my son and my wife. Because yeah. no one man can build a family. No. Man can have a set of children, but you know, can't build family without the steady female. And Mr. Brown and my wife, the way them children move, the way the children move together is the main evidence that is a well-built family, you know?
Sure. Good guidance, Dylan.
All right, thank you very much, dear, sir.
Yeah.
Next one, good morning and welcome to Straight Up, hello?
Yeah, good morning.
Morning.
Yeah, you remember Mr. Peterson's birthday?
Oh, yes, no, I never remember. Never remember at all.
Come here, so open now here, and then go here, and one that message here, most November say, a piece of touch birthday, and my 19.
Never remember at all.
Yeah, man. You know, big up in family them, you know?
Yeah.
And the music, they must live on.
But not do your head, man.
Eh?
Not do your head.
Jerry, you met people them, I last time I live at Bellevue, and you know, tell them, say, they mustn't say so because of you, they just have to, you just leave them for something.
You have a place named Bellevue, right? It's not Spanish Town there too, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Mm. I don't think it's that safe you live there, so do.
Why, Jerry? When I turn on the radio this morning, I try to listen to Sharon. I'm a member of the holiday. The blown out. I try to listen to news, no news.
Yeah.
I'm going to say, all right, Jerry, I'm going to come on.
Oh, you know.
What do you mean, man? You're not leaving, and we're not leaving, no care what.
Yeah. So how other room sounds are empty?
Jerry.
Eh?
I'm in my shower.
Oh, them take out your belt and your shoelace?
Jerry. I'm not lying, I'm glad you come on, because kind of entertain with sailors.
That's why you're showering?
What?
That's why you're showering?
I'm showering, no Jerry.
Oh, that's a normal shower.
Yes, Jerry.
But I know water run. When you come out of the back, so you come out of the bathroom with the towel and then when we put your hand on your back hot like or no, you never be it.
Jerry, we couldn't have on the water your talk.
Oh.
You understand?
Yes, yes.
But it's like you're upstairs.
Alright, thank you very much, dear.
Yes, thank you. The rest of my brother and sisters and all the and Jerry.
Yes.
What you tell him, say, so Jerry, you said at the same time, me hear my brother come out with it for the year. I mean, if I'm in the same state, but Jerry, family liquor, my mother tell me, she said, she should have a son, and in 6 weeks, and one woman said to her, she said, she should have God seen dead.
Uh-huh.
And she said, at the same time, I never used prayer God seen dead. One night is at the same time there. And ask God to help him.
Yeah.
You understand? And him leave.
Yeah.
You understand? And Jerry, come on, tell my brother and sister them say, you see the same time them brother might use with some foolishness, Jerry.
Yeah.
Jerry, them can use that same time, Jerry, and turn that something positive, Jerry.
Yeah.
You understand? Make people have, them nobody not afraid of them and them not afraid of people. You understand?
Yes, and them can never left them yard without money. And them get for go any and go in and get in anyway.
Yes, all you mean is them good, you know what you them say? Good care to the world.
Yeah, all your friends, you carry your friend too.
Are you of course, carry a body with your come.
Yeah. Alright, thank you very much, yeah?
Alright, listen.
Next one, please. Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome, sir.
Yes, how are you?
Fine, thank you.
Yes, Jerry. You know what I'm trying to say? It's Jerry.
Yeah.
You have too much whims and luckies.
Mm-hmm.
Instead, we don't stand for them rights, the basic human rights, you know?
Yeah.
I make fighters and champion them, you know?
Yeah.
And be as if they have more rights than you.
Yeah.
And I'd like to make a call to the rest of the Marcus Garvey Party and the Black Americans.
Yeah.
To take the British government to court and sue them for preparation because you can't believe it. If it's don't stand for right, they ever seem as if they're own masters that I would do. Because right here on the mental slavery, you know. I would emancipate our minds and mental slavery by first standing for rights.
Yeah.
And uniting.
Yeah.
And I'm believing equality because of the weakness of slavery, we suffer inferiority complex. We suffer with lack of opportunity. You could have even more backup that millionaires that people can reach further. So one thing that comes out of slavery is that stand for your rights, believe in yourself. You're just as important as a white man or anybody else about any other race.
Yeah.
And start making fights and jumping on you.
Yeah.
I think it wouldn't support you. In the 90s, it messed with this country under FinSAC. Where this country $120 billion debt. And I just know he's coming out and talking out about separation. We know for a long time.
Yeah.
So I don't know if it's this country, this body, you know why. But better on much of this country.
Yes, listener.
Yes.
The other day, a couple of weeks ago, Farrakhan did keep a celebration, almost a 20-year anniversary of the Million Man March.
Yes.
And they were supposed to broadcast the rally in America there straight to a screen down in George William Park, down in downtown Kingston. You hear anything about it?
No, sir.
I would like to hear from some people who are there, especially two young ladies who came to this program about it.
Yeah.
How that whole broadcast and that relay went, you know? But thank you very much for your call, yes, sir?
Yes, sir. I saw it's the police. thank God for Indicom, because them walk around and shoot down innocent people. Yeah, people say they trust the gunman more than even the
police. Yeah, that.
Yeah, because they may say, you and shoot down. If a gunman don't have a reason to shoot, if you don't blame him, not shoot, you know. I don't say they don't kill you.
Yeah.
But the police,
the gunman have some bad reason too, different from not having a reason. Some of them have some bad reason, like for instance, are your relative, so them just kill off the whole family. But thank you very much, dear.
Yes, sir. Thanks.
Good morning. Welcome to Straight Up, hello. No more there. Yeah, so this is National Heroes Day. We don't have the benefit of our production assistant to answer the text messages. But we're going to go and take your phone call in the meantime. Good morning, welcome to Straight Up, hello.
Hey Robin, morning man.
Wagwan.
You said morning, you know?
Yes, sir.
I say Ross Michael get
National honors, yes.
Yeah, get an honors and that's good. And I think Tekna get one thing.
Who that?
I don't want to mistake. But
what name did it call?
I think Aquafitin, the father must get one.
Oh yeah, I don't think so.
I don't sure. It's an OD and anyway, I just use a medium for something.
Yeah.
You into the banking sectors, right?
Yeah.
So you have that card where you go to the money machine and draw money.
Yeah.
At the 4th of August, I had banked some money in a banking sector. And when I went here and banked about 46,000.
Hold on. You went into a bank and did it?
Yeah, I go into the bank and put the money in the bank.
Yeah.
You know, that's when you're on the road and you're and draw the money.
Yeah.
There's a certain ATM machine at a pharmacy on Mullines Road.
Yeah.
I call the remember Sir Maddy.
Yes.
Right? That I went. And all the while it's convenient to where I live. So I could go there and draw the money.
Yeah.
When I put 46,000 in the account on the 4th of August.
Yeah.
The 10th of August I went back to draw some money. Finding out that I only get 10,000 because there was a lot of money in the bank.
Before?
Yes, yeah, so I get 10,000.
Yeah.
I wanted 18,000. But when I start drawing again, I see it's insufficient funds.
Wow.
So I see a man come and then go in and get money. So me that say at the box, not the money.
Yeah.
I ask him if I get money, he say yes. I'm going back, insufficient funds. Go back again, so three times me trying out, I'm going to say insufficient funds. So right away, I know I'm going to contact the bank.
Yeah.
Anyway, go to the bank and things. Would you know that on the 7th, I'm going to draw all my money at Black River and Brownstone. You understand?
Right.
Yeah, them draw. So I don't know the cloning go, but that particular machine. I hear some people been losing money left, right, and center at that machine.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. But I am only putting out there that people must be aware of that machine.
Yeah, I have three bad experience with money machine, ATM.
ATM.
Between 2002 and 2004, and I stopped using it completely.
Yeah.
Because the bank knows that they say me get robbed. One time the money go back in, I draw some money and my glasses drop, same time and I bend down to pick it up. And by the time I pick up my glass and raise up back, not even 4 seconds, you know. The money was sent out to me, draw back in. And the bank know when I go to the bank immediately, them know, you know. And the bank manager refused to give me money. That means him and the other people in the bank get the money then. And some of that similar things like that. I stop using it because I don't want to commit myself criminally.
Yeah, but what I say is that I am lucky because I went in and I do what I have to do to get back my money.
Yeah.
Some people may not be as lucky as me.
Yeah.
So I called up to the entity that I banked the money at half a tree there.
Yeah.
And they give me back my money.
Yeah.
So I'm just putting it out there that people see that machine.
Well, may I tell you, the Scotia Bank at Hagley Park Road, 3 miles, refused to give me back the money after them, no, say.
Well, it was one of them. It's a bit too neutral. I go, you know.
All right.
I get back my money, and I say, cool up to them. When good things happen, if I talk.
A plenty bank, yes. When good things happen, I talk. But a plenty bank, me have to close down account, you know, when I'm a fornicate.
But this
now, I give me my money. I forgot, but...
these money machines are some set of scam thing are going on in a
different yeah.
You understand? Because the next man, me hear a ball.
Yeah.
I'm a shape made. So I just want people to know so that much a particular machine at the pharmacy on Mullines Road.
Yeah, I know right. I know it's man.
Yeah, because there's things going on there, Bridget.
Not marvelling.
Yeah.
I know it.
I say no more, sir.
Thank you very much.
Yes, sir. What good, sir.
I want somebody already for bill here of yes, that man. Of that place.
Yes, man.
Thank you very much.
Dangerous.
Yes, sir.
You know, but I get back my money still.
Alright, thank you very much.
Yes, sir, yeah.
Good morning, welcome to Straight Up, hello.
Morning again.
Hey, Wagwan.
But to the brethren, they don't most necessarily the machine when get it from there. Can somebody, inside Brownstone or next place, them take the money? Or can somebody, not that bank, no,
inside.
Give him information or something, you know?
Inside job.
Them somewhere, them get some farmer ID somewhere and clone it.
Yeah, man, business, a big yeah, business, Wagwan, big business.
Yeah. But you know.
Yeah.
So, when you bend down and that money go back in, you never get back that money?
No. I go straight to the bank when I lodge the money, I hug the Park Road. I'm dealing with the man to himself. Three times I go there, you know.
Yeah.
And him no say the money draw back in. And him not giving me money.
Yeah, better man than me, boy.
Him
not give me back.
Yeah, but you see, as he said, a temptation, I'm a temptation. That's why plenty of time I walk, I left some things, you know, and don't go back there. And take it as a school fee, me pay, because it's a temptation.
Okay. Yeah. That's why I'm locked down all of my account.
Plenty of time.
I'm locked up tomorrow, and I'm forgetting it in cash.
Plenty of time, lock it off.
Yeah, one car about though. When you talk about the indentured business, people come from India and while them there, India, Britain Arab for them country and thing.
Yeah.
But you know, sir, even the same India, Britain you know, in colonizing India, it caused enough problem at Jamaica with the rest of them too, with the ganja business. Because the first time, the reason they make ganja illegal first, you know, are from India, you know.
Yeah.
Right, you know how don't have a Cali?
Yeah.
That name that I think, that name, I believe that name, I'm not 100% sure, I believe that name come from the reason why they make it illegal. In India, the people were used to fight the British government, like how the Maroons do down here. Them used to worship the god Cali.
Yeah.
And them used to smoke, you wait.
Mm.
Smoke them ganja. So them notice, wait, how come are them man who are... I wonder if I should answer this thing and make them so brave that them
abide. Not only that, anywhere them go and anything that is that big, anything that is big and big trade. Because the same way, the Britain go down to Hong Kong and China and want to take over the opium trade, drugs, you know. The British government want to take over opium trade and drugs, and when the Chinese don't do it, them go to bomb them. I forgot our next call, because I don't want to cost nobody.
But that they don't make that for come ganja come
all in. All well, up to now. Cameron is a feisty. I don't know if a son him is. Thank you very much. Good morning, welcome to Straight Up, hello.
Indeed, brother Jerry. Stick to the good word.
Yes, sir.
Did you saw that story recently, Jerry, where a Jamaican man was held in the Bahamas prison for 9 years? And what his lawyer said was some chumps of charges that didn't exist.
I remember vaguely, but I can't remember the detail.
Well, I'm wondering if he will not press this one further, whether to the Caribbean Court of or the UK Privy Council.
Yeah, well, a lawyer should direct him.
Absolutely, because this is serious.
Yeah.
You know? Anyway, we listen to hear what happened here.
Yeah, man.
Okay, man.
Thank you very much, yeah?
Cool.
Good morning, welcome to Straight Up, hello.
Yeah, Robin.
Welcome, sir.
I just want, on that note, that the gentleman, the brother, they say that, if me not know, I do tell him, so we do homework.
Yeah.
We do homework and find out where, yeah. And it's not me alone.
Yeah.
More than one people lose their money right here.
Yeah.
So we did homework.
Yeah.
All right? And tell him, say, it is the people who are driving a brownstone and them place there. But do a homework and find out where the money I draw from. Because you can't find out these things, you know.
Yeah.
So when you have internet and you know your code and all of that, you can find out. So tell me to do homework. I know where it comes from.
Yeah, man. And so there George Nooks. I have must have $15 million in our account. And them dry it out.
Yes.
And when him a complain to the bank I tell him say...
A woman.
The bank I tell him say a female girlfriend work at the bank and that is a private affair, not a bank affair, imagine.
So, you know, tell him say, I don't know, mistake. When I just get up, that's why I'm not calling no name and no place and so. The only one entity I call and the entity that give me back my money.
Yeah.
You understand if you know, so I do it.
Yeah, man.
So tell him say, we do homework and we know what I go on.
All right, thank
and
you.
And you say anytime you push your money in the machine, it takes forever to come out.
Yeah.
Be careful. It's supposed to come out with a urge, a rush.
Yeah.
And it now come out with a rush, that take time and you have to pull it out. Be careful of them box there.
Yeah.
You understand? All right,
thank you. Next one. Morning. Morning and welcome to Straight Up Today. One?
Morning.
Yes. Welcome. Good morning.
Morning, sir.
Yes, sir. Welcome.
Oh, go on.
Fine, thank you.
I call if I want to send cash, you know.
Yeah.
There's no problem with that. I look up place in your Alkirk Drive.
Name what?
I name Alkirk Drive. Just as a pass, Dove Cut.
Yeah.
Next avenue from your left hand side. Some people leave some land there. They look up bridge and look up bridge and get a better deal and shut out. Then go on somewhere else.
Yeah.
I leave now me to go and plant at the place and deal with the land because I'm gone.
Yeah.
And next 3 months time is like the thing to work out. And the man come back and a beer war vibes when the man come here.
Who bring in the war? Who bring in the war?
The man who come back to his place and any old man, you know, 60-year-old man, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm an old deportee. Without the run of 25 years of prison.
Hold on, him lease out the land or what?
No, the people give him the land to go and plant.
Oh, and is him allow you to be there?
Yeah, him allow me for that.
So what him bringing war on you about?
And him come back, him say him gone to a better place.
Yeah.
Him all get banned and big out and them things. I want to go out to Medina.
No, but when him come back to you now, what him want you to move?
Yeah, him want to move off of things and them things.
How much time him giving you to move?
That's why I make the announcement now for the people who control the land for coming in. To come rectify the situation. Because 3 times I have to call the police, you know. Man, chop up
melon. But I ask you a question, you don't answer me.
Eh?
I ask you a question, you don't answer me.
The Upper Land?
No. How much time him give you to move?
He's not giving up. He's not giving up. It's not, all right. Me have some jam on it.
No, hold on. Listen. Deal with one thing at a time. How much time him give you to move? Like, say, you better move by weekend.
As him come back, him just start telling me I have to go move.
Yes, you have to go move, but you don't ask him by when.
He's not giving a time.
Listen. You are listening?
Yeah.
If somebody say you have to move, you don't want to know from them by when you must move. You don't want to know that?
Yeah, man. He said the first time he said he's not giving me a month.
Yeah.
But the things that I ask for is
yes,
I'm not going to take a month.
Okay. So it's not...
Up to a year and add.
Yeah, okay, so it's not going to take a month. Which crop take more than a year? Some orange tree?
Yam.
So yam take more than a year?
The melon, will be here and go back to beer again. Yeah, 6, 7, 8 months, melon will be here.
All right, hold on. So you believe, all right, so it's going to take up to a year, right?
Yeah.
And your point out, say it's going to take a long time. What was his response to that?
He said I'm not busy, that the first time I chop up the thing, I'm calling the police. And the policeman telling me, where
yeah, but you, every time I ask something, you're still telling me a different story. This story, I'm going to take up too much time, you know. Since him object and say, I'm not giving you a year, what is the next thing him say?
Him just start damage up my things.
All right, him start damage your things. So,
yeah.
And him go away. And him come back every day?
No, man, him come back, him live on the place now.
Oh, him live there.
Yeah,
so when you report him to the police,
yeah,
you have any paper that like you lease the place?
No, I don't know people need any. They just leave it alone.
Why are you telling me some other story? Ask me one thing about you. And
no, I don't have no paper, Jerry.
All right, so you don't have no paper. So I don't know. I'm not a liar.
Policeman even
listen,
said that.
Listen to me now. You're not listening to me, man. Hear me now. But you talk to me, you're not listening to me when I talk to you. I am not a liar. But I know that even when you don't own a place and you're squatting upon a place, after a while, you're going to have certain rights. And therefore, even if you don't have certain rights that you've been living there 12 years, even if you're there for a short time, you should supposed to get some time. But I'm not a lawyer, so I can't give no detailed advice about it. Yeah. But I could hear from some other people here.
But more
no, I'm telling you, I have to go to the next call. I can't spend no more time now. I can't spend any more time on this call. Don't we have another call?
You hear me, Mr. Jerry?
Yeah, what is it?
We just want the people who want the land up for alcohol drive to come in before bloodshed and certain things go on up there. Because
you going, you, hold on. Apart from you calling the police, you see?
Yeah.
You willing to shed blood?
No, I'm not shed no blood, but he want to shed blood.
Oh,
and
so, all right.
Me up and go back
all right. Prison. Okay, so you intend to make your blood available for him shed?
No, man, I protect myself, man.
No, different from protect yourself. You don't want to leave the scene.
I come out, I don't have plan, no fun. I just reap and I come out.
Why are you telling me different thing? I am discussing leaving to you and you start telling about planting. You can't take a long argument. That's why when you don't deal with things promptly one by one, you hitch up one place till somebody come chop you. Me say if you don't want to leave, why don't leave the scene instead of make him chop you?
Yes, man. I have a farm in front of the farm, you know.
Yeah.
Living at the place, you know. I have a farm in front of the farm, you know.
And therefore what?
I may have pepper, may have chili and wood.
Why are you telling about pepper and may I talk to you about bloodshed and to save your blood from shed? Why are you telling me about pepper? So because you have pepper, you're going...
All right. Come off and left my hard work in...
No, well, all right. Here we do now. Here we do. So, all right. Here we do. Don't hear what me saying. I'm prepared for your bloodshed. But I don't really want you to do that, you know. But if you're not going to hear me, I'll
give
you
no good advice, man. That's why enough people not call for advice, you know. Because
oh, so I'm here to turn for now. Anyway, don't chop me. Please don't chop me.
I'll tell you.
All right, thank you. Don't chop me. May I tell you? You see it? I ask him who wants to shed the blood for him. He said no, he's the next man. And eventually, I'm telling you, and I feel for him now, because I'm plant, because when you plant and walk hard in the sun, it really look hard for you get up and run left thing. But don't you have to make up your mind. Enough thing me walk out because I have picnic now. Because I could have started things or get involved in things in a certain year. But true, me have children. You know, so if you do anything, when you go on to work, they might come for your picnic. So you have to weigh these things and weigh these things. What I must tell you? I must tell you what you want to hear. Must I tell you what you want to hear when you call people or even call somebody upon the roadside or call a relative and ask them what you must do? If you don't like what your relative say, you're going to cuss your relative. People must always tell you what you want to hear. I don't believe so. And I don't want to hear say get chopped, but you don't want to hear neither. But I'm glad that you were here today. And I'm glad that I was able to do the program. I will look forward to a regular day's program tomorrow. One time, my producer. I mean, well, Mr. Vince. How you pronounce his last name again, man? Clennon. Vince Clennon, man. He's a combination of technical operator and producer and everything today. Thank you very much. Straight up.